I was pretty lucky, like in like pretty many moments.
Ureshi, saikou.
I know that I could survive if you roll the worst possible scenario on the last game.
Here we go.
There's no other option.
What?
It happened! It happened!
Bibiho!
What the heck?
How did you do that?
What are the odds?
Somehow I get away with it.
これレプラの4歳の娘が書いてくれたんです。今日のために力になってます。
My match tomorrow against Batoon. I think I'll casually beat him.
強いプレイヤーと戦えることとても嬉しい、楽しい。
Batoon, prepare to lose.
All right, Matsun, prepare to lose are the words from Pin Ping Ho coming into this one. Welcome back, guys. I'm Doa. With me is D2, of course, as we go into our second best of five of the day. But what do you think, D2? Do you think Pin Ping Ho's predictions will become correct?
I don't know. I've been watching Matsun for a while. I know he's a very strong player. He can perform when he's deprived of sleep to the tune of 80 hours.
That was really impressive, yeah.
So, I mean, I think it's going to be a close game. Obviously, Ping Ping Ho is an amazing player. Got to BlizzCon last year, got to the top eight. So I'm really looking forward to this one, honestly.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, anyone who watched those Japan qualifiers really kind of saw the strength of Matsun. And sometimes, to a certain extent, when you're traveling like this, too, that stamina that you need to kind of keep playing, keep your head in the game, really sort of comes out big.
Yeah, and we saw yesterday, I mean, between Ping Ping Ho and, what was it, Sogi? Mm-hmm. When they played, I mean, they were basically done. They were, their heads were fried by the end of that match, and a lot of misplays, but definitely understandable misplays because it can get very tiring when you're making so many decisions.
Yeah, that's right. So, guys, if you've got something to say about the next match or anything, really, you see in the tournament, tweet at us at PlayHearthstone, hashtag HCT. But this time, right now, let us know who you think is going to win, hashtag Matsun or hashtag Ping Ping Ho. We're going to find out in a few minutes what you, the fans, think. After those intros, though, it's going to be interesting to see what the fans, who the fans pick. I've got a feeling we'll have to wait and see. For now, though, let's get to introducing our players. We're going to start with Ping Ping Ho.
All right, here we see Ping Ping Ho coming on the screen, a very good player. Obviously, the champion of Taiwan, plays a lot of control decks, and the casual wave to the crowd. I wonder what he's thinking right now, whether he's going to crush Matsun like he said he would.
I think that's exactly what he's thinking right now. He's like, I'm very well dressed, I look very neat, and I'm about to crush my opponent. It's pretty much what it is.
Absolutely. Probably what he's thinking, yeah.
I would
have to go with that.
So his opponent, though, the one he has to get through to exit out of this group in the number one spot is going to be Japan's own Matsun.
Matsun, another very strong control player, brought all control decks to the Japan preliminaries and for this tournament as well. It's actually his birthday today. He turns 28 years old today.
Wow.
So happy birthday, Matsun.
That's amazing. And we'll see if he gets a birthday present here with a win over Pin Ping Ho. It's going to be a hard-fought match either way, but I love it. It's like it's kind of like Matsun represents kind of like Rocky Balboa, right? He just keeps getting hit and he keeps getting up and he's eventually going to win it, right? Where Pin Ping Ho, he's definitely like the big, confident Russian dude in whichever Rocky movie that was. I don't know. I've never actually seen any of the Rocky movies, but I've seen clips of them, so that's what I got.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah. I'm actually wondering what shirt Matsun has for us today. It's a new shirt. Yesterday he had the Leprenome shirt. It said Leprenome under that in Japanese in case you can't read Japanese.
I can't read Japanese.
But he expressed very eloquently in English, I would say, give me a big hug. That's what he wanted to get from his daughter who drew that for him.
Cool.
I wonder what Hearthstone card we have for him today on his shirt.
I don't know. If he wins, I think we're going to find out. Let's take a look at our poll results so far, guys. Let's see what you, the fans, think about this next match. And wow, overwhelmingly in favor of Matsun. That's like the biggest lead we've seen in the fan vote yet this weekend, I think.
Exact opposite of yesterday when he was down to Naviut. But what we had were a lot of Japanese people on social media saying, I mean, there was the hashtag Ganbare Matsun hashtag, but people changed. There was a notice out there saying you have to actually just put Matsun there in order to vote for him in this certain poll.
Hmm. All right, well, there we go. The Japanese fans coming out in force for their hero. We'll see if he can take it and exit out of this group in number one.
Absolutely. And we have the bans coming in here. Looks like Pingpingho's Druid was banned. Not too surprising considering Matsoon's overall strategy. And Matsoon's Murloc Paladin was banned. I'm very sad. We're not going to have any crazy Murloc Paladin mirror moments.
I'm not sad about that. I'm just going to be honest. I'm happy. I'm happy we won't see a Murloc Paladin mirror. But we're going to see a lot of great games either way. So what do you start with if you're Matsoon here? What do you think is going to be the way to go?
Well, I mean, he kind of put together his list in order to defeat, you know, basically aggressive decks, things that are good against Druid, which is why he banned Druid. Like I mentioned yesterday, he's basically countering the counter to Druid in this instance. So for Matsoon here, I mean, he could just start off with a Druid. That's a pretty normal strategy. He could also just go for something that maybe he wants to beat two or three decks there, but looks like we're going to be getting into the game here and finding out soon enough.
Yeah, man, I think it's time to get things started here at the Hearthstone Asia Pacific Winter Championships. We're into day two. We're into our second match of the day. It's going to be Matsoon versus Pingpingho. Big talking versus, what would you say for Matsoon? Maybe like
quiet strength.
Yeah, quiet strength. Oh, wow, there you go. I'm going to let you write what I say from now on. That's nice. All right, it's going to be Malygos Warlock coming out of Matsoon versus the Warrior for Pingpingho.
Right, and this is a matchup that we saw yesterday as well between Matsoon and Naviut. And actually, Naviut got a little bit greedy, wanted to save his removal and basically take out minions, you know, kind of the, you know, less efficient way so that he could keep his efficient removal for later. But it cost him in the end when Matsoon was able to put together enough damage for that lethal. But this matchup is definitely, I would say, favored for the Warrior because they're able to just, you know, tank up and armor up out of range of the crazy Malygos combos.
Yeah, I mean, to a certain extent, you kind of run into a little bit of a similarity between Control Warrior and Freeze Mage, right? Where there's only a finite amount of damage that the Mage or the Warlock can do. But I feel like the Warlock's in a little bit better spot, at least you've got some minions,
yeah, exactly.
You know? At least you've got some minion damage coming in, like those. Maybe not the minions you want in your opening hand, but they're good later in the game.
You know, they're pretty nice, especially with the coin. He can go, you know, turn 3 Twilight Guardian, turn 4 Twilight Guardian. Pretty tough minions to deal with. And yeah, basically, because of the fact that, you know, the damage isn't likely to kill the Warrior, the main strategy for the Malygos Warlock is to just, you know, zoo it up. Just get as many minions onto the board and deal that minion damage.
Yeah. It's going to be a little bit more of a slow start, though.
Pingpingho making sure that he takes time on every single turn. Yeah. He mentioned in the information that we got that sometimes he just likes a rope just to calm his nerves, and looks like that's, you know, his strategy right now. Basically, if you can keep your mind calm, you can play well over the course of the series.
Yeah, kind of put your opponent on ice a little bit too. You know, sort of make them a little bit more nervous if that's what they're feeling.
Absolutely.
Fans wanting Matsoon to be legend.
That cool video that we saw.
I'm guessing
earlier.
He probably already is legend.
Yeah,
he's probably been legend a couple times.
Right. Yeah. I think he's made legend every single season.
At least twice. So Pingpingho, a couple fiery war axes in his hand right now, but no real reason to play them. Kind of expect just an armor up here.
Well, he could set up the fire war axe for future turns. He has a turn 3 turn kind of in that shield block, but
yeah,
on the other hand, you know, one of the ways you can win this is just to remove everything from your opponent and they can't possibly kill you, so armor up wouldn't be too bad either.
True.
Overall, I would say, yeah, I think you're right, just go for the armor up here, especially because if you pick up a Deathbite later, you're going to be regretting having that, you know, having equipped that fiery war axe.
I mean, the only argument I could see for it is that you've also got Slam in your hand, so it'd help you deal with a slightly larger health minion. You can deal with up to 5 health on turn 3 then, if that's the case. But we'll see. It kind of depends on what he thinks he's going to see out of Matsoon.
Right, I mean, I guess you maybe are worried about the Blackwing Technician?
Yeah, that's
because
possible.
Because he hasn't... Because Matsoon's game ended quickly enough that Pingpingho doesn't really know if Matsoon is running Imking Boss or Blackwing Technician.
Yeah.
Or maybe, you know, two of one and one of the other or something like that. So Pingpingho is not going to take any chances. And he can just armor up next turn, I suppose.
Yeah. Hero power is not going anywhere.
Next.
It's always available.
Well, just once per turn, though, unless you have Justicar.
That's true. All right. Shield Maiden is the draw. This seems like an armor up turn to me.
He could go for the shield block to give himself more options. His hand is kind of bare. I wouldn't be against that. But honestly, it's kind of... Basically, Pingpingho, it seems kind of insignificant to us, you know, armor up or shield block, but he's thinking about all the permutations down the line about what happens if I armor up here, how much armor can I get to, if I shield block here, am I going to regret it if I pick up shield slam? All that kind of stuff is running through Pingpingho's mind right now.
I'll see just how liberally wants to be with his cards. Okay, he's going to go for the cycle, essentially. There's a brawl. That could come in handy later, but honestly, if you're playing against a Malygos Warlock and they've got like three or four minions on the board, you're going to be taking so much damage anyway that that brawl may not have come soon enough.
Right, and the thing about Brawl, when you're playing against a deck that likes to run big minions, or even something like a Rogue, where they don't have too many minions, it can just, you know, serve as basically a random assassinate. You know, basically, right. you throw it out there, even if there's only two minions on your opponent's side of the board, they're two beefy minions, and you just, you know, get rid of one.
That's nice, a good point. I suppose that is true. Twilight Guardian number one gets coined out by Madsen. So that's already a high amount of health to deal with, but drawing into the bash does actually allow Pinping Ho to kill this pretty cleanly, if he wants to.
Yeah, I think that's a pretty good use of bash there. You can, I mean, obviously you don't get to fit in your hero power, unfortunately, but that's a pretty small price to pay for. I mean, when you can just bash something down, this is basically 1.5 card for a very premium minion, I would say, on the side of Monsoon. I think you're happy with this if you're Pinping Ho.
Yeah, it's not the most mana efficient turn, like we talked about, but there's no real other way to kill it.
You could slam revenge, but
you could, but that's a lot of cards to use on one dragon.
But if you think that there's going to be no revenge value for the rest of the game, then maybe you just decide you're going to be mana efficient right now.
Could keep it for an execute later on, I suppose.
That is true. That's very true. You're tossing both of your execute activators in that instance, so that could be, that's definitely right. So all of that going through Pinping Ho's mind, and he decides in the end to go for that bash. Nice and easy play. Yeah. I mean, to the viewers at home, it seems like maybe he's taking too long, but this is a very important match. He wants to make sure he's not making any mistakes here.
Totally. So there's Antique Healbot in the hand. Madsen could just play that second Twilight Drake that we like we talked about.
Yeah, does he go for the Twilight Drake or the Twilight Guardian? Because I was wondering whether he wanted to bait out some removal, but looks like because he doesn't have another activator for the Twilight Guardian, he wants to just get it out, and he can play the Twilight Guard. Excuse me, the Twilight Drake later.
Might as well. Ooh, Elise Starseeker is the draw. So, like we talked about earlier, you could slam Revenge along with the Fiery War Axe to get rid of the Twilight Guardian. But is it tempting just to play Elise and armor up? I'd be tempted to just play Elise and armor up, but I over-prioritize Elise like way too much and I play Control Warrior.
Yeah, it has nothing to do with, you know, getting the golden map into your deck or getting to the golden monkey quicker. Basically, what this would do is just develop your own minions.
Right.
If you're reacting, I mean, Warrior likes to react, but at some point you like to have minions to do some minion-to-minion combat, so you're not reacting every single time. So in that sense, I just like getting the 3-5 out there.
Yeah. What now? I like it too. Still get to armor up, still a clean turn. Might as well. I mean, Twilight Guardian.
You don't get
doesn't
to armor up, but.
Oh, yeah, you don't. You don't. I was an art major. I didn't do the math.
Yeah, there's been some crazy math moments. You know, all of our brains are pretty fried, but ready for day two here.
All right, so he goes with the Elise Starseeker. And do you run into the Twilight Guardian or not?
I think you do because you have that second Fiery War Axe. Obviously,
okay.
I mean, you might. Here's the thing. You could decide to play Shield Maiden next turn, and maybe you pick up. I don't know. Because if you pick the Shield Block, the Shield Slam, maybe in two turns from now, you'll still have the armor to be able to kill something. So it's kind of close, but I think this shows to me that he wants to definitely play Shield Maiden next turn.
Yeah, he can still kill the Guardian between his minion and the axe. See, Warriors need dual wield, man. They need to be able to equip two weapons at once. Wouldn't that be awesome?
It would be awesome. Maybe
we
a bit broken.
No.
It would be pretty amazing. I agree with
you. How could you ever break that? Impossible. Deathspite in one hand, Gorehal in the other. Okay.
Oh, I don't think you're breaking the weapons. You're breaking the game. I like this by Matsun. He just weakens up the Elise there and hits the face. You do want to remove that armor as much as possible. And, you know, you're the aggressor. You want to kill your opponent. So going face whenever you can is important here.
Yeah. Yeah, you got to get the damage in because you have to set up that spell damage opportunity later on. That's very true. So he can kill the Twilight Guardian.
What?
He could just slam and see what he draws into as well.
Right. I think he's just going to play the shield. Oh, no, he's going to go for the slam. I guess the Death Lord kind of changed his mind. Maybe he can, you know, pick up an execute or something like that off of this draw and have a chance to deal with whatever comes out of the Death Lord.
See, I'm surprised that he slammed the Twilight Guardian because now he has to use both minions to clear that.
Oh,
maybe he's
going
to go for revenge.
He's going to clear both.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Guess what? Pinping Ho has a plan.
He does have a plan. Yep. Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't expect him to, you know, slam and cross his fingers, right?
Yep.
Since he's Pinping Ho. It definitely has a plan for every single turn. I mean, obviously it's up to debate whether that was the best move, but it's pretty reasonable. I mean, as Ping Ping Ho, he doesn't want to get in the situation that Na'Vi had gotten to yesterday, where he's just taking a lot of damage. He says, okay, not playing any game, just removing every last minion.
And now seems like a good turn for a hero power into Twilight Drake.
Exactly.
Yep. Grabs a Lotheb, and yep, that's just a Drake with 9 health.
Yeah, and we talk about, so there's a shield summon. Unfortunately, Ping Ping Ho can only go up to 5 armor maximum this turn. And we talked about how this is an unfavored matchup for the Malygos Warlock, but this is one of the advantages it actually has, right? It gets to keep getting new cards, gets to keep, you know, drawing into new answers, and meanwhile Ping Ping Ho has 5 cards, only a few of which are actually usable.
Yeah, that's, I mean, just kind of the classic Warlock edge, is that you can run the Warrior out of answers faster than really other decks can when they play against this control Warrior. What's it gonna be though? I feel
he was hovering over that Death Lord. Yeah. So
I think a Death Lord at least is part of the turn anyway.
I mean, he could just go for the Shield Maiden, but I mean, basically Ping Ping Ho is kind of, he's respecting Matsun right now. He's respecting that Matsun knows that, you know, he has to get rid of the armor of Ping Ping Ho. So he's thinking that if I go for the Shield Maiden, then my armor's going to get shredded next turn, and there's going to be no trading into my Shield Maiden unless it's a really good trade with the Defender Varagus or something like that.
Yeah. So do you take 3 health off the Drake here? Looks like Ping Ping Ho doesn't want to. Wants to, you know, when you have that Shield Simon in your hand, I suppose you might as well save the armor, huh?
Right. Well, he could have attacked first and then armored up. Maybe he kind of, you know, got flustered at the end of that turn. And we do see the Imking boss, so slightly less likely that we'll see the Blackwing Technician in this match.
Yeah.
So many possibilities.
So we could see a Tempo Soulfire here just to, you know, get the ball rolling for Matsun.
What about something like a Dark Bomb and then finish it off with a Mortal Coil for the cycle?
Right, that could be useful as well. The problem with that is you don't get to play your Lotheb, which is it's a beefy minion. You kind of want to get that out there, but you're right. He could just go for that and go for the Imking boss as well. We'll have 4 mana remaining if he goes for that. And he's going to go for that play. Definitely makes sense. I mean, he's making a slightly weaker play, but he'd be not, you know, tossing away one of his more important minions or important cards in this instance.
Yeah, just doesn't want to discard. Gets the Azure Drake, which is a nice body, but you don't get the draw from it like this.
The nice thing, though, is that you don't, I mean, you're a Warlock, right? So you're kind of okay with it.
Yeah. Wow. I thought we were going to see the Imp Gang boss there, but he taps and gets a Zombie Chow, so he gets another minion out there. And you want to try to force a brawl, right? You want to get just enough out that they brawl, but not enough that you're overcommitting.
Absolutely. And I think that was part of his reasoning, too. I mean, if he doesn't tap, then he's not getting into his answers. And if he plays the Imking boss out right there, then maybe that's a sufficient enough brawl for Ping Ping Ho. And then once he picked up the Zombie Chow, he said, you know what? It's kind of okay if this Zombie Chow gets brawled here.
True. Not giving your opponent too much health back.
So Ping Ping Ho here obviously can use his axe to kill either the Zombie Chow or use it with revenge to kill off the Azure Drake. He can also use it to help. Well, he can shield maiden shield slam off Twilight Drake. So a lot of options here for Ping Ping Ho. He can also just go very greedy, play Death Lord, and make sure a lot of stuff comes on the board from Matsun and then brawl.
I kind of like the Shield Maiden here. Shield Maiden, Shield Slam.
Ooh, he's not going for it, looks like.
No.
Yeah, he's not going for it. Yeah, he's going for the greedy play here. He wants to make sure that he gets a really quality brawl. It definitely makes sense in the context of his hand. His hand is pretty low at this moment, and he wants brawl to get as much value as possible.
Okay, so 8 mana turn now. A lot of options for Matsun to choose from.
Right, the problem is that if he goes for this Blackwing Corruptor, it doesn't really help him as far as killing off this Deathlord. He could go for the Hellfire for 4 damage, but yeah, not really worth it. Gotta pick up an Owl.
Ooh. Well, I suppose, to be fair, there's not a ton of silence targets in Warrior, but...
Right, and the nice thing is that you're not getting a big minion out for your opponent to brawl as well. We might just see a tap pass here.
Well, man, I mean, I bet
he has 10 cards, so he needs to play something.
I bet he was pretty terrified that one of those Death Lords would bring out his Malygos before he drew it, you know?
Yeah, well, before he drew his Malygos, obviously, but yeah, that's pretty terrifying.
The first one.
Especially when, you know, there's such good removal in the arsenal of Warrior.
Right. He's almost out of time now, though, so what do you do? Just Azure Drake for the draw? But again, you know, you're just worried about the brawl.
He's going to overdraw if he plays the Azure Drake, so right. Gonna just be... He could just play... Healbot, yeah, just to get back up and health. But, wow,
BGH.
Double BGH.
Wow, he plays both BGHs. He really wants Pinpingho to brawl here, but giving both of those up, I don't know. Do you think that's wise?
Well, let's look at his reaction. So, no reaction, so he was, I guess he was expecting it a little bit. I wonder if wanted to just YOLO it out, you know, and hope that he didn't get punished, but, well.
I mean, I feel like that had to be to try to force the brawl, right?
Yeah, otherwise. I suppose. And what this does is it allows him to tap more. Obviously, he was really handcuffed. He couldn't play his Drake because...
True.
Yeah, because he couldn't... He's going to overdraw, obviously. So maybe he figures that his Imp King boss is more important to him than the Big Imp Hunter. Since the Big Imp Hunter only really gets value against a Grom in this matchup.
Okay, so saving the Brand Bronze Beard.
I think if he ran into Drake, would he overdraw?
No, he wouldn't. Not now, no.
But...
Second brawl drawn by Pinpingho. So
you know what he could do is if Pinpingho gets a bit greedy. Sorry to cut you off there, but
you totally cut me off. It's okay.
If Pinpingho gets greedy, then Matsun could go Bran into Lotheb and just shut out every single spell.
That's true. You're not gonna play anything that costs 10 more.
And the thing is, people talk about that like kind of jokingly, you know, because usually Lotheb is good enough, but to lock out every single spell, you can't even brawl at all, even for it's just cost 15 mana. So, I mean, Matsun, maybe he just builds up a board and goes Bran Lotheb and just says, okay, now I'm going to get an extra, a lot of damage in.
I like it. I like it. And the other thing to consider, too, is that a lot of warriors, you know, really good spells, Shield Slam, Execute, all that kind of stuff, can be played even after Lotheb comes out because they're so cheap anyway.
Absolutely.
So, it's going to be Shield Maiden from Pinpingho along with that Acolyte of Pain. And yep, just going to shield slam the Azure Drake, most likely.
Okay, are we going to see a Temple Malygos here? Because Matsun just saw a shield slam. His opponent has two cards in hand. We could see a Malygos into Mortal Coil to kill off that Shield Maiden.
True. Oh, yeah, that's right. Wow.
That might be the play here because, like we said, you can't really burst down the warrior with a combo, you're more likely to kill them through minion damage. And if he can get this Malygos down, it looks like he's not going to go for that. Going to go for the clear on the board. It makes sense in a way because you don't want to give your opponent extra cards. And, you know, being able to kill off this Acolyte right away is kind of nice.
And I suppose.
Like he's choosing between the Blackwing Corruptor and just throwing this Imp Gang Boss in, looks like.
I feel like I'd use the Imp Gang Boss just because you've got a chance to Bran then the Corruptor later on, but he's going to use it. Building the board a little bit more.
All right, I think this is actually setting up for that Bran Lotheb turn just to have as big, just have as much stuff on the board as possible.
All right, the Golden Monkey's in the deck, and there's an Execute. That is a crucial draw for Pinpingho with a Malygos coming in the near future, probably.
All right, are we going to see it? Are we going to see the Bran Lotheb to lock everything out? Pinpingho not going for the... Ooh, okay. So this could be Matsun's opportunity right here. Could even play the Dark Peddler and then Bran and then Lotheb to get a lot of damage onto the board.
Yeah. We go Bran, Dark Peddler, Lotheb.
Oh, you're right. Discovery. You're absolutely right. My ordering is horrible. I'm sorry.
Well, he's got a lot of cards in hand, so you always have to be worried, too, to not overdraw. But this time, he should be able to make it work. Let's see what he gets.
Here we go. So Voodoo Doctor, none of these are really too helpful.
No, not the greatest.
Yeah, Corruption, you don't... I guess you could Corruption and then, you know, make it so that your opponent doesn't get the best...
Ugh, that's a... pretty bad set of discovers
right.
there for Matsu.
He definitely wanted more damage, but goes with the tournament attendee. And I really want to see this Lotheb here to push that damage into the face.
Tournament attendee is like the least flattering name for the card. It's like, yeah, he was just some dude that was there. Just your average.
What did he say?
Attendee.
Straight lines, please. It's very very. There we go. There's the Lotheb, and everything is very expensive for Pinpingho. Cannot even play the Execute. Picks up the Shield Maiden. Let's see if he goes for the Grom or the Shield Maiden. I imagine Grom takes off 5 damage off the board and provides, you know, pretty big body by itself as well. So I'd like to just see the Grom here. Maybe,
you know, without that armor,
it
would have been lethal for Matsu.
Oh, would it
next
have
turn?
Been?
Yeah, with Malygos and Soulfire.
Wow. Okay. So my mistake there.
Yeah, he would have had
going for the better play.
Would have had just enough.
That is an abusive Surgent. So how much damage do we have here? We have 17 on the board.
Right,
plus
and then
nine.
Another, potentially 9, right?
Yeah. Right.
Huh. So it's not enough to kill him now, but
26.
Yeah, if that Shield Maiden hadn't come out, that would have been the end of the game.
Well, Grom could have killed one of the Blackwing Corrupt or the Blackwing Corruptor, so that is a bit.
That's true.
That takes off some damage.
But I assume you just kind of go to the face with everything, get him so low that you almost certainly kill him with Malygos, right?
All right, we have the double buff on this Abusa Sergeant, getting nice trade there. Of course, I could play the Abusa Sergeant with the Malygos and the Soulfire. But let's see if he commits to the board. Probably not. He knows that Brawl could be a possibility in his opponent's hand.
Yep.
But Healbot is on average bigger than the stuff in the deck, and he gets all the way back up to 30. So
that Healbot is basically Reno Healbot because it just brought him all the way back up with 16 more health.
All right, pretty obvious Brawl here.
Yep.
And we'll see if he's concerned enough to go for an execute play with the Revenge or if he decides to go for the Harrison.
Who survives?
Oh, Lothep, the biggest creature on board. That is huge for Matsuin and very painful for Pingpingo here. Does he commit to the Revenge and execute?
Yeah, he could kill it. He's got a chance to get rid of it, but that would also make it hard to activate that Grom Hellstream too.
And because of that Healbot last turn, Matsuin can tap with impunity. He's not worried about dying to any Grom nonsense at all.
Yeah. Reno Healbot, man. That's a dangerous combination. Brand, Bronzebeard, Antique Healbot.
Absolutely.
Comes Reno Healbot. All right. Tough turn for Pinping Ho.
Yeah, he's thinking, what has my opponent been setting up this entire time? Do I need to go for this Revenge Execute? And it looks like he's going to opt for it. Gonna believe that in the future he will draw more options.
But dude, when Matsuin sees this, he's like, all right, time to play Malygos, isn't it? I mean, just saw an execute get used. Your opponent only has two cards in hand.
He could just go for Malygos. The problem is, are you Malygos and immediately soul firing?
Yes. Yes. Look at that. You've got like Voodoo Doctor, Tournament Attendee, Zombie Child. You've got a lot of stuff you can discard.
Yeah, your hand is pretty subpar, so the only thing might just go for it. Oh, he's hovering over it.
I think he got it.
Here we go.
Yeah.
Here we go. Is he going for Tournament Attendee?
Whoa, okay,
interesting.
Well, I was not expecting that. But I guess next turn you do theoretically have the win with Dark Bomb Soulfire, right?
He played around Grom Execute.
Yeah.
He played around Grom Execute, the tournament attendee blocking his opponent from being able to, and that just it? It's 17 damage from the Dark Bomb Soulfire. That is going to be it. Matsuin is going to take the game. Tournament attendee MVP.
Pretty brilliant play from Matsuin, actually, even though we saw that Execute come out. Even though theoretically you could play the odds, but the execute came into the hand, so he played around the only way that he could theoretically lose that win condition. Very
absolutely
nicely done.
Beautiful. And this is the second time that Matsuin has taken out a control warrior with Malygos Lock. Maybe it's not as bad as we expected.
I don't know, man. I'm just impressed, dude. That was such a great game from Matsuin. Pinpingho, I mean, he played, I think, about as well as he could, but in the end, yeah, the Malygos Warlock, the only one in the tournament, the only one we've seen in a while in a lot of tournaments, gets the win.
Absolutely. And the one problem was that Pingpingho had kind of a subpar hand, you know, didn't get those shield blocks to get those shield slams in. And for Matsuin, I would say he had a pretty good hand going, you know, starting from the beginning of the game, had those double Twilight Guardians as well as the Twilight Drake, just had so much pressure from the beginning. That's really what you want to see, and got Malygos at the right time. Really played it well. I mean, made sure that all of the removal options were away from his opponent before he played it, and got the tournament attendee right in front to protect it.
That was a
separate
cool
lines,
game.
Please.
That's right. Well, there was only one line right there, and it led right to a game one win. So while we get set up for game number two, guys, let's get to know Pinpingho just a little bit better.
I'm Kuo Pingho. I'm 28. I'm from Taiwan. For Taiwan's Hearthstone scene, right now we have like several top level players in Taiwan, but there are many of them because most of people couldn't make a living out of it. Many people think that I'm special for playing Shaman, but I don't think that's an important part of me. The reason why I play Shaman is because I want to have my personal style, but it doesn't have to be Shaman. I usually show my style through some kind of special like deck buildings, and it will make people think, wow, this is Pinpingho. Some people play Shaman in the Europe and America Championship, but they suck. They are not Pinpingho style. Because there's no imagination, they are not creative. At 2014, people thought I was the best Hearthstone player in Taiwan. Right now, I think it is Tom 60229. But who cares if I'm the best? I'm still going to win the Winter Championship and win BlizzCon. Since BlizzCon, I've been doing nothing other than preparing for this Winter Championship. For every day for me, it's usually like waking up 2 p.m. in the afternoon, and maybe eat some breakfast, and then play some Hearthstone. Go to eat dinners, and I'll go back to playing Hearthstone. And I'll play Hearthstone until I go to bed. I usually take a lot of effort into relaxing before tournaments. I usually practice a lot less. I will make sure that I am in my best state when I play the tournament. My number one supporter in this world is me. Winning this tournament will mean a lot to me because I have never really won a major tournament, and it has always been my dream to be a world champion. For people who don't believe that I will win, who cares about them? I'm still going to win. This weekend, when I'm playing my match, please spam 国平得第一 to show your support. To all my opponents this weekend, I have to say sorry because they might have to try again. My name is Ping Ping Ho, and I'm here on my road to BlizzCon 2016.
I think Ping Ping Ho's video might be my favorite player enter. I'm not going to lie. That guy is hilarious.
Right. I mean, I have some national pride for Matsun, but I can't help but just love Ping Ping Ho. He's amazing. And I mean, back in the day, you used to cast StarCraft 2. I used to watch Artosis as well. And the only thing I can think of when Ping Ping Ho talks about smashing his opponents, just, you know, the nerd smashing that Artosis used to talk about all the time. And Ping Ping Ho basically embodies that.
Pretty much. I mean, he's off to a good start. He took out Selgi yesterday, I believe, the only Korean player to not win in day number one. And he's not quite doing as great this match, but it's only one game. It's a best of five. You can definitely come back. And we've seen him so far be able to kind of back up the tall talk.
Absolutely. Wasn't able to take that game, though, but played it pretty well, at least from our vantage point. We'll see what he can come up with in game number two.
That's right. And more importantly, I'm wondering what he's going to bring. Is he going to stick with the control warrior, do you think?
He could. We could have a warrior mirror, or we could have a druid versus warrior. Now, the warrior versus druid matchup has improved significantly.
Uh-huh.
That's what we see here.
Yeah, druid versus warrior. So Matsun bringing out his druid for his second deck. Ping Ping Ho sticking with the control warrior, though.
Exactly. And Ping Ping Ho, he didn't ban the druid like we thought he might. Matsun did ban the druid of Ping Ping Ho. The thing is, Matsun's druid does, on paper, very well against Ping Ping Ho's decks, but the decks have kind of been, you know, altered a bit, especially this warrior from Ping Ping Ho. It used to be something almost 70-30 at its worst, you know, speaking of the advantage for druid against warrior, but now it's very close to 50-50 because of all the removal options that the warrior has. It's just called removal warrior, right? Because you just remove everything from your opponent's side of the board, you stay alive, and then even the druid runs out of options and they can't kill you because of the Justicar tank up.
I mean, back in the day, I played way more Control Warrior than anything else, and Druid was always the matchup I feared the most on the ladder. And I mean, it has gotten a lot better because Warrior's just simply, like you said, gotten more removal. Now you can just play that pure removal style, whereas before you had to kind of get things done with minions too, and you couldn't really deal with everything Druid played. So the matchup is better, but it still might be tough for Ping Ping Ho too.
Yeah, absolutely. Indirectly, Elite Starseeker allowed the Warrior to put even more removal in its deck and not have those expensive minions like Alexstrasza and Ysera, because they just turn into legendaries anyway in those control matchups.
Yeah, very true. I mean, we've seen even some warrior lists that don't go above Justicar Trueheart in terms of big minions on the top end if you've got that Elise Starseeker in there.
Right, so we've talked about how the warrior can win this matchup. Let's talk about how the druid can win this matchup. Basically, you get as many minions on the board as possible and just try to basically as many beefy minions that are difficult for warrior to deal with in one turn as possible.
Right. So just the armor up for Ping Ping Ho, and then over to the 4-mana turn for Matsun.
Matsun, I mean, obviously a perfect turn right here with Pile of Cheddar, but has nothing for the next several turns. That Wrath is not what he wanted to see. He's probably going to have to just cycle it.
At least he's got some flexibility, right? He can if he draws into like a 7 drop, he can use the innervate to play it. So we'll see. It really depends a lot, though, on what he draws into. In the meantime, Pinpingho picks up his first Deathlord, which doesn't seem like the worst play. Could just go for the Coin Elite Starseeker, too. It is, like we talked about last game, a 3-5 body on the board. It faces the Pilot Shredder, at least.
Right. I mean, this is another one of the cards that really flipped this matchup around a lot. Because you're able to play so much removal, that leads you to being able to play Deathlord as well.
Yeah.
And it really slows down the Druid that to throw so much damage into it. But looks like it's going to go for the Starseeker in order to be able to just combat, to contest, excuse me, that Shredder very well.
I like it. The map to the Golden Monkey is in the deck. And we're getting into the early this time, so maybe we'll actually get to see the Golden Monkey.
Right. I think Pingpingho, he just wanted that body, right? The body is very nice against the Shredder right here. And, you know, in the future, he might be able to utilize that Golden Monkey if he's in a rough spot. But for now, this is pretty nice for him to get this at least out here.
Yep.
Force Nature, not what Matsu wants to see either.
No, it's not a minion. I mean, something like an Azure Drake would have been pretty ideal there, right? You could just innervate that out.
Absolutely.
Cycle more, get a 4-4 on the board. But
or just have the assurance that you have a minion in the future to play.
Yeah. Even that, it's not so bad.
I do like this play. I was going to say, I wonder if he goes for the B-Game Hunter and just hits the face here. Both of these contest the Elite Starseeker. And, you know, Matsun's reading that if his opponent had a Fiery War Axe, he would have used it already.
True.
Very, most
very
likely.
True. So Pinpingho with maybe not the cleanest turn 4. A couple Acolytes of Pain, still has the option to play that Deathlord.
I think he does go for the Deathlord because he's coming up on a Brawl turn. And the question here is whether he trades for the Big Game Hunter and just gets stuff off the board, or if he kills this. Oh, an egg.
Oh.
Interesting. That's very bad for Pingpingho's Brawl. But good for the time being because now there's less damage onto the board to take care of this Deathlord.
That is true. I mean, we know he can take it out a couple different ways.
Right, just go for either the Force of Nature or go for the Keeper of the Grove with the Wrath. He could actually go for
Wrath Hero Power too.
Yeah, he could Wrath Hero Power. He could Wrath and cycle for one, then play the Keeper and innervate in Hero Power as well.
Do you think that's using too much?
I think that you're kind of desperate at this point. I mean, he did pick up the Shade, which is nice, but he's kind of desperate for minions. He's desperate for pressure onto his opponent.
I suppose.
So,
see what
I mean,
he goes for.
Even just, you know, you're using so many cards, but at the same time, you're using cards that aren't useful to you right now. So, you kind of just want to get into your future options.
Right. That's in thinking long and hard about it, though.
Absolutely.
Yeah, how do you handle the Deathlord, cycle the most, and also kind of save the most resources at the same time? It's going to go for the Shade of Naxxramas. He can still take out the Deathlord with the Innervate.
Yeah, I think he's going to go for the Shade and toss in the Big Game Hunter and Hero Power as well. No, he's going to change it up and go for the Keeper. And I feel
silence.
Oh, okay.
Look at that. Just going right to the face. And so Matson, knowing that he pretty much has to get the damage done now with the minions he has because he's just not drawing more.
Right.
I get this line of play, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Nice draw.
So even though this Big Game Hunter gets killed, I mean, he gets the 4 damage in, you know, beforehand. And what Matsun is thinking here is that, you know, why did you play that Deathlord? Why did you go for the least first? Maybe, you know, you're looking for that Brawl in the future. And we see that Matsun has a 61% win rate as a Druid against Warrior in ranked matches. Pretty a normal set. I mean, obviously you face a lot of patrons as well, but, you know, normal win rate, I would say, for a Druid, for a good player.
Seems about right, especially in the control matchup, you know, Druid versus Control Warrior. Versus Patron, Druid probably doesn't do quite as good, but...
Right. So maybe a bit more impressive than I'm showing here, but...
Well, there was those, 6 months where it was only Patron.
Absolutely.
That time happened. We're trying to force out of our memories, but it did happen.
Well, when it was the Warsong Commander, you know, when Warsong Commander before was nerfed, it was basically a 50-50 matchup with Druid at the time anyway, so it wasn't too big of a deal. I mean, that kind of was the reason why Druid was so good. But looks like Matsun is finally going to commit to the board here. And could we see a Brawl, despite the fact that Pingpingho has a couple minions on his own side?
Well, he's going to probably want to clear some of the minions with Death Rattle first before he brawls, I would imagine, right?
Right.
Yeah.
He could just go for Justicar here as well. I mean, it's really hard to get Justicar out versus Druid a lot of the time. You know, they're putting so much pressure on. But if you can just develop it, and every single time you weave in a Hero Power, you're doing so much healing and getting out of range of combo, it just feels really good.
Now, what if you bash the Piloted Shredder? Okay, he's just going to go for the Justice Car. Never mind. Forget everything I'm saying. He's going to do something completely different. You're right, though. I mean, in this matchup, it is kind of tough to find a turn to kind of squeeze that in. And while you have the Sludge Belt... Excuse me. While you have the Sludge Belt Trail, you might as well, right?
Yeah, absolutely. That Sludge Belcher is very annoying to get around. Yeah. Matsun's going to get slightly rewarded for keeping his Wrath, as he can take out that Justice Car pretty easily. Mm-hmm. Picks up finally a minion here. Probably want something like an Azure Drake or an Ancient of Lore instead, but this will have to do.
Yeah, it's a little bit late. Would have liked to see that Druid of the Claw a while ago.
So the math is kind of clunky here. He could actually still cycle the Wrath. You know what? This is one thing that we saw from Amnesia a lot. Even though sometimes he had very clean removal with the Wrath, because of the state of his hand, he liked to use Wrath as cycle a lot of the time. And I think this could be one of those situations where Matsun's kind of forced to cycle with the Wrath right now.
That would open him up to some more damage. You gotta do what you gotta do.
Exactly. I mean, you're staring at your warrior. I mean, the situation in which the druid wins against warrior is that the warrior just desperately removes every single last thing that you have.
Yeah.
And, you know, they're running out of cards. But it's the exact opposite situation right now. I mean, Ping Ping Ho has plenty of cards to spare here, and that's gotta be daunting for Matsun. But it looks like he is going to go for three, it looks like.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, despite needing those cards, he kind of needs that survival a little bit more. And I'm going to go for the Druid of the Claw. And there's a Gore Howl. Wow. I feel like that was a pretty good turn to draw that.
All right, so Matsun has two cards in hand. That could be combo if you're Ping Ping Ho. So can you play the Gore Howl here and survive?
That's a good question.
Your opponent would have 22 damage, and you would go down to 19. So yes, you would die to combo.
Yeah, might be one of those necessary brawl turns.
Yeah, especially because of the shade on the board.
Yeah. The tricky part is that you'd really like to pop the Nerubian Egg before you brawl, just because you don't want to have to deal with that 4-4 Nerubian, you know, and maybe another druid minion that survives.
Ping Ping Ho is hovering over that Gore Howl, though. I mean, it kind of makes sense, right? Go for the winning play. If you play too defensively, even though he feels like he's ahead, which he pretty much is, if you go for the defensive play too often, then you allow your opponent to kind of catch up. All right, so he's going to go for it. Probably going to take out that Trog as well.
Yep.
And that means that... Oh.
Whoa. Okay.
I guess it doesn't matter too much. He's dead to combo anyway, so he might as well not just, you know, throw away his stuff. But I'm
Savage
pretty
Roar
sure...
Would do it.
I'm pretty sure that's lethal if Savage Roar is picked up here. Let's see if it is. Nope.
No, doesn't
Azure
get
Drake,
it.
I mean, if you're not going to pick up lethal right now, you might as well pick up, you know, Azure Drake. That's pretty nice.
Yeah.
Probably the second best after Ancient of Lore if you're not going to pick up lethal.
Gets him a chance to draw into that Savage Roar again or something else useful. There's that's a Lotheb. Lotheb's a good draw, too.
It will shut out Brawl, which is very important. Yeah, and he's going to go for it.
Yep.
Definitely
yeah,
makes a lot of sense. And swing with that Shade. So, Ping Ping Ho in a lot of trouble here.
Yep, draws into a 7-mana slam. That's not going to do you a whole lot of favors. Could play the Grom Hellscream to take out one of these 4-4s, I suppose.
That's basically all he can do.
Yeah.
He can play double Acolyte and, you know, tank up, which is... It's healing for 2 less than killing one of the creatures because of Savage Roar. I mean, if you're worried about Savage Roar, that is.
Yeah. Well, he probably should be.
Maybe a little bit.
Maybe. Okay.
Right. So he's going to go for that. And let's say we have 9 damage on the board, and we have 7 damage from hand. That's 16, so that's just game.
Yep, that's right. Looks like Matsun is going to go up 2-0 in this series. Gets the Living Roots for a little bit of extra damage that he doesn't even need. And Ping Ping Ho, all that big talk, but he's going to have to climb out from quite the deficit here in his second match at the Asia Pacific Winter Championships.
Absolutely, and good play by Matsun. I mean, there were a few decisions here and there that were pretty tough there. You know, how to manage the Deathlord, for instance. You know, went for the damage play, realized that with all the cards in my opponent's hand, I need to tempo him out of the game. I cannot, you know, outvalue him in the situation, which sometimes Druid can do, but not in that game.
Do you feel like Ping Ping Ho was just a little bit too hesitant to play those brawls?
He was really worried about that in the Nerubian, it seems like.
Yeah.
You know, you brawl, and all of a sudden, you brawl, and in a lot of situations, your opponent has 2 minions left on the board, and now you have to deal with those, and you don't even really have that much removal in your hand other than that, so I can see why he went for it. I kind of have to admire, you know, his courage, basically, to go for the Gore Howl. I mean, he was rewarded right away for that that moment, right? But then, you know, the Azure Drake into the Lotha, basically the worst thing he could have seen there.
Yeah, it did not work out for him. So Pinpingho still needing wins with Warrior, Warlock, and Paladin. But now Matsun only needing to get that final win with Warrior. And if he does that, he's going to 3-0 Pinpingho, which is something that nobody expected to happen. A lot of people rooting for him out there on the internet. But I think we all thought it would at least be a close series. Might still be.
Might still be, indeed. I mean, we saw Matsun go up 2-0 versus Naviut. Naviut was making a fight of it, you know, afterward. He was able to take a win, and then after that, you know, he was fighting. He basically got tempoed out of the game with his Warrior against the Malygos Lock. But we'll see if Matsun can finish out the game. I definitely want to see what's on his shirt as we see it there. But
yeah, that's the real reason.
That's
right?
The real
reason.
We've
got to find out what's on that shirt. Looks like we're ready to go into what might be the last game already in our second best of five. Matsun just needing that one win with Warrior. Pinpingho, a couple decks to choose from, but no matter what he picks, he's going to have to make it work.
Absolutely. And, you know, Pinpingho, I wouldn't put it past him to be able to take this back and take this win. Looks like he's going to go for his Demon Handlock first.
Yeah, Demon Handlock. So it's interesting to see Handlock coming in here where you've got so many Reno Locks, so many Zoo Locks, especially right now. But Pinpingho kicking it a bit old school.
Right. The thing about Handlock is that you're going to lose to a lot of the meta decks, but at these kind of tournaments, you're expecting your opponents to have decks that beat the meta decks, and you can beat the decks that beat the meta decks.
So that's so what next level mind games.
That's what you got to go for when you're playing for the Asia Pacific Championship, Doa.
Very true. Kind of a rough looking starting hand for Pinpingho, though.
Well, he does have that Void Color, so if he picks up something to pair with that Void Color, it can be very explosive. And particularly when you're playing the Handlock, you're not doing too much until turn four anyway, and you're going against a Control Warrior. So I think he's okay with it.
Now, with Control Warrior against any variety of Handlock, really, you have to be very choosy about your removal. You have to make sure those executes, those shield slams, go on just the right targets. Otherwise, you can find yourself in a place where you're kind of hoping on a lucky brawl, right?
Absolutely. And you do have those brawls in the deck, but the biggest thing that Matsun has to be concerned about is Jiraxxus.
Yeah.
Because, you have to deal, this is why this is such a hard matchup, especially for this new age warrior, right? The removal warrior, because you can't remove everything in the Warlock when you're just pumping out 6/6s every single turn. And you're using removal, you're just trying to stay alive, you're taking care of everything, and then, you know, after the Handlock has used up all of its big guys, he goes, okay, here we go, the biggest guy, Jiraxxus. Mm.
The biggest guy of them all.
The Eredar Lord of the Burning Legion.
That's right. Yep. As he likes to tell us all the time, Jax is so annoying to, like, go out to the bar with. You're like, hey, man, let's grab a drink, Jax. He's like, did you know I'm Eredar Lord of the Burning Legion? Yes, you've mentioned that several times before.
Way too many times.
Yeah.
Jax is.
Heard that one.
Jiraxxus is, sorry. All right,
not
here we
Jiraxxus.
Go. So the thing is for Matsun here is, the reason why this isn't as good a matchup as it used to be, it always was favored for the Handlock, but there were certain times where you could get minions on the board that were very threatening for the Handlock, and they'd have to remove them, and if you didn't have an answer, then you could, use that and turn that into a victory for the Control Warrior. But basically for Matsun, you're really only looking at Grom. So you really need to just use Grom at the exact right time to kill your opponent. Really hard to pressure them. In the meantime, you're just gaining as much armor as possible and looking for the right moment. You know, hopefully you get something like a Harrison off on their Jiraxxus weapon so that you can, get those cards to be able to burst your opponent down.
Yep. Pretty classic Handlock start for Pinpingho. Just a couple turns of life tapping into that Twilight Drake. Matsun, though, going to throw down the Unstable Ghoul.
Right, so this is a really older card seen in this removal type warrior.
Yeah.
Eversixion is the one of the people who kind of pioneered this type of deck, speaking of this, removal style warrior. And that was one of the first, tech cards that was put in the deck, is that Unstable Ghoul. And it allows for draws with that Acolyte, obviously, but also is very good against aggro. Not going to be too great in this matchup, however, for Matsun.
Well, Pinpingho gets the option to Dark Bomb the Acolyte of Pain and prevent more draws from Matsun when he goes in with the Unstable Ghoul. Could still play that Mountain Giant, though. So what's he going to prioritize? Getting the big bodies on the board? Kind of checking his hand for any early executes?
I feel like he has so many big bodies that you just throw them out there.
Yeah, might as well.
At some point, they're going to get removed anyway, and there's really no way they're going to have removal for this giant, removal for the next giant, removal for the Thorisin, and then the Dr. Boom, and then the Void Call, and then the Mal'Ganis. So
yeah.
I think if you're Pinpingho, you say, okay, let's just throw them out there and see how they do.
Well, they're not going to do that well this turn because we've got a Shield Slam and an Execute to deal with both of the minions. But then again, that's one Shield Slam and one Execute down, and Pinpingho now has a better idea of what he can play safely.
Definitely. Not very likely to see another Execute, another Shield Slam in the hand. And like we mentioned, there's just, you know, there is threats to go around if you're Pinpingho.
Yep. So 10 cards in hand for Pinpingho right now. I feel like this is a good turn for Emperor Tharizin.
Could be the case. However, it does die to Despite that we see is in Monsoon's hand. So maybe he goes for a card that his opponent can't deal with. Even though it seems, you know, you want to be mana efficient and play out the Tharizin. But in reality, an 8-8 should be costing more than 6 anyway. So maybe you just go for that Mountain Giant. Looks
true.
Like he's going to go for it.
Okay.
And
thinking about it.
Either the Dark Bomb or the Ancient Watcher as well in order to allow him to tap in future turns.
Decisions.
Yeah, being able to tap every single turn is very important if you're the hand lock. Sometimes you see people just toss away cards in order to be able to do that.
He's having a hard time deciding. There we go. So Mountain Giant does come down. And he'll use the Dark Bomb, yeah, just trying to deny all the draws he can from Matsun.
Yep, and Matsun does pick up a shield block, however, to be able to draw. And wow, that's a Shield Slam, so nice.
All right, well, that came at just the right time. So he's going to be able to get rid of the Mountain Giant very easily. But after that, do you coin out the Shield Maiden, maybe?
Yeah, it's either the Shield Maiden or the Sludge Belcher. I was about to ask you the same thing. It's pretty close, right? You want to get some damage on the board.
I kind of like the Shield Maiden a little bit better just because you get that 5-5 body.
Yeah, I mean, obviously the Shield Maiden is just straight up a bigger Maiden than the Sludge Belcher. So in a vacuum, you'd want the Shield Maiden, you know, if he had 7 mana, for instance. But I mean, the coin, how valuable is the coin here is the question.
At this point in the game, I'd feel like it's not that valuable. Next turn, you'd still be able to Sludge Belcher Hero Power.
What if you're on 9 mana? What if you're on 10 mana and for some reason you needed to go armor up, Justicar, armor up, and then play and execute?
Well, I suppose that's a scenario that might have existed in one game at one point, yeah. That's possible.
But yeah, you're right. Probably fine to just use the coin here. Unless he has a way to kill his opponent next couple turns with a Grom, which doesn't seem likely.
Looks like thinking about using the coin.
Yep.
Do it. Okay, yep. Shield Maiden. Just get a little bit more armor, get that 5-5 body on the board.
Yeah, from here on out, the armor doesn't matter for Shield Slam purposes, but, I mean, 44 health, not too bad.
Yeah? And I mean, yeah, having more armor is definitely a good thing. There we go, Dr. Boom coming out now. And so he's got a number of ways already that he can deal with this. He can bash and then run a Shield Maiden in. Doesn't draw into a BGH, but he does draw into an Execute. Yeah.
Let's see if he goes for the shield block first. Actually, he could just go for a shield, or excuse me, a bash and a Deathbite attack as well.
That's true. You've got plenty of armor. I like that. I like saving the execute because you know that Mal'Ganis is lurking in there somewhere, right? So that's something you kind of need to save the
execute
for.
That's what turtles do. That's what turtles do. They lurk around
in
your hand.
That's right. Mal'Ganis lurks too.
Yeah, he does. He is a turtle, and so therefore
he's a turtle.
I am Mal'Ganis. I am a turtle. I am eternal.
Oh, I never thought of it that way before. I don't know.
He's a turtle, man.
He's not a very convincing turtle, is he?
not at all.
I saw him walking down the a dirt path next to a stream. I wouldn't be like, there's a turtle. I'd run for my life.
Because he's actually a massive demon.
Yeah, he's literally a huge, terrifying demon. So it will be the Deathbite and the Bash to get rid of Dr. Boom. And a little bit more damage to the face. Pinpingho getting a little bit low health total-wise.
Right, but these double mortal coils means that this Shield Maiden's going to go down relatively easily. See how much damage is.
Four really easily.
Just kills it off right there. Big Boom was like, "That I had many ways to deal with that.
It's like, I didn't even mean to do that." All right. Well, yeah, might as well just drop a Void Caller. You could even drop two Void Callers, I suppose.
Yeah, he could drop two. I think I would like a tap first here. Maybe just tap into Void Caller and Ancient Watcher. That's not a board that ever gets brawled anyway.
Yeah. If you play the Void Caller into this.
Huh.
Yeah, okay. So basically, if he plays two, he guarantees that Mal'Ganis doesn't take damage from the Deathbite instead of an Execute.
Oh,
so
right.
That's a good reason to play both Void Callers.
Well, the Deathbite was played first, so it wouldn't do damage anyway, I believe.
Yeah, that's true. The Death Rattles for the Void Caller would happen next. Yeah.
Well, Slam is picked up, so Monsoon does have a way to deal with the Mal'Ganis that would come out if he decides to kill these Void Walkers. I'm actually somewhat surprised to see that. Huh. Well, he does pick up the Acolyte, which is pretty nice for him. So now that he has picked up the Acolyte, well, he can't play the Acolyte and the Slam and the Execute, so that's unfortunate.
Yeah, and I feel like you do need to get rid of one of these White Collars first, just to see what comes out.
You know what? Maybe he's thinking that he can just play Sludge Belcher here.
Could be.
And if one of these Void Walkers slams into it, then he can kill both with the Despite at the same time.
That's true. I like that, actually. Yeah, get a little bit more value out of the Death Spite that way. You don't have to find a different way to get rid of the other Void Caller. I like it.
All right, let's see what he goes for. He's thinking about this Acolyte, thinking with. I mean, he can also take the 9 damage, honestly.
Yeah, I suppose.
But he's going to go for the Acolyte, it looks like.
Wow, really prioritizing that draw more than anything.
And he's not going to swing, though.
No, not even attacking. Okay.
All right. You know what? I think that might have been just a last-minute play from him, and because I don't really like it, to be honest.
I mean, it to me, it seems better to get that Void Walker, or Void Caller rather, doing its thing, deal with what's out. You've got the Slam and the Execute. You know, no matter what it is, you can handle it.
Right, and if he had played the Sludge Belcher, he likely kills both of the Void Callers next turn.
That too.
And,
yeah.
And he can play the Acolyte as well, and then draw a bunch of cards. So.
Yeah. I'll get a Mortal Coil, the Boombot, throwing a little bit of damage. Only two, no big deal. Tons of armor anyway.
Interesting that he just didn't tap there.
Twilight Drake? Probably. I mean, you're still worried a little bit about the Brawl from Pimping Ho's.
How worried is Pimping Ho about Grom? Not at all. I mean,
apparently not at all.
Well, because
I
it is,
feel like you should be a little bit.
Well, because he's on 9 mana, so there isn't going to be any Cruel Taskmaster if it's in the deck.
Yeah.
So he can only do 14 damage with Grom.
Yeah. Still, though, at 14 damage, you have to be.
That is true. He doesn't have any healing either, so it's kind of.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Doesn't have any healing and has only Mal'Ganis and the Sludge Belcher to keep him alive and would die to some sort of bash.
Have both bashes been used, though?
I think we've seen one.
We've seen one for sure. I'm trying to remember if we saw two. Either way, now Madsen has a bit of a tough turn because he's only got that one execute left. What he wants to use it to deal with the Molten Giant, but at the same time, you know, you got to be worried about Mal'Ganis coming out of those Void Callers.
Yeah, definitely. So, I mean, this is basically the strength of Ping Ping Ho's deck, right? This is why he brought it. He was expecting a lot of control. And you can just overwhelm even the removal warrior, the class that removes, the deck archetype that removes stuff. You have too much stuff for them to remove.
Yep. Just going to go in. We're going to find out. And Mal'Ganis should be taken out.
Oh, it doesn't kill.
Oh,
that's unfortunate.
Oh, he uses the Execute on the Molten Giant. Okay, so Mal'Ganis only has 7 health. He is easier to deal with in the end. So it looks like Madsen just counting on taking care of it next turn, I suppose, which, honestly.
So that's a bit of an interesting situation there because he killed the Void Caller, and then the Death Rattle of the Void Caller went off and produced Mal'Ganis, and then the Death Rattle of the Despite went off. Even though the Despite was played first.
Huh, but that's why it didn't hurt Mal'Ganis, though.
Right, so that's the thing. The fact is the attack came first.
Sure.
So there was the attack that killed it, and then that procced the Death Rattle, and then the Death Rattle of Monsoon came out.
Makes sense. All right, well, Pin Ping Ho thinking about going in. He does take out the Slime. And now, finally playing that Emperor Thoris, and with Mal'Ganis having to be dealt with pretty quickly, that actually makes it pretty safe for Emperor to stay out for maybe a turn or two.
I was thinking whether Ping Ming Ho wanted to Sunfury Protector his Thorisin to protect his Mal'Ganis.
That's a nice draw for Madsen, just being able to stay alive as long as he can with all that armor, but you gotta deal with the minions too.
Yeah, unfortunately, being able to tank up for 4 doesn't counter the 9 damage of Mal'Ganis every single turn.
Not quite.
We see the Battle Rage, which is a card that was confusing to us yesterday.
It's still confusing to me now.
Oh, well, it was confusing because we thought it was, you know, Patron Warrior for a second there. But
when we saw that in the initial hand, but then we figured out it was just thrown into Control Warrior. There's the Lotheb.
Yep, Lotheb is pretty painful here if you're Matsun. And, I mean, if you're Ping Ping Ho, basically Ping Ping Ho here is saying, I don't really want to play too hard into Brawl.
Yeah.
And so how can I pressure my opponent enough and still be able to, you know, if I get Brawl, then it's still fine.
Defender Vargas. So maybe you play like Sludge Belcher here. Twilight Drake.
Right.
Sludge Belcher, a little bit on the board.
Yeah, even though Sludge Belcher dies to the Shield Maiden, it still blocks it off from killing your Mul'Ganis, which is very important.
Right. You could use one of your Taunt Givers, too. I'd lean more towards a Sun for your Protector, just because you're kind of counting on things getting brawled anyway. But
he wants to use as much mana as possible. If he's going to...
So.
Yeah. I mean, basically, the Sun Fury Protector, a lot of times, is more valuable than the Defender of Argus, because you get to play it for cheaper. Even
True.
Though you get that buff, you can play in kind of a pinch.
It's a big dragon.
It is a big dragon. Unfortunately, Matsune, in order to activate this Battle Rage, he needs to actually just use his Revenge rather than attacking it with his Shield Maiden.
Yeah.
It's a play we could see. We could also see Grom Revenge and take out this Twilight Drake, and then take out the Mul'Ganis with the Shield Maiden, and then kill the Defender, but that involves drawing zero cards.
Yeah, you don't really want to do that, but Mul'Ganis has been alive for a few turns now. It's getting pretty scary.
Got some tweets coming in for the Malilog play from Matsune. I would say, it was masterful, but in this game,
great.
Definitely against the ropes.
Yeah. It's a tough matchup, though. I mean, it's smart for Pinpingho to bring a deck like this.
All right, so going to go for that Battle Rage.
Okay, draws into the Death Spite. Couple more weapons, but that's not the most useful thing ever, is it?
Yeah, not at all.
Just go for the Justicar, man. No? He's going to armor up? Huh.
Yeah, I felt like Justicar probably would have been a better choice there.
Yeah, you might as well get it down, right? I mean, that's a...
Maybe he's feigning Brawl.
Maybe, I guess, but if he would have Justicard there, he would have gotten the same armor as if he would have just armored up last turn and next turn.
Right.
So. But you would have had a 6-3 on the board, too.
Yeah, definitely.
And the tank up hero power.
And the tank up hero power.
That's right. So, potentially a good amount of damage coming in for Pinpingho. Still wary about playing into that Brawl.
Okay, so, we're going to see a cycle here from Pinpingho.
Yep.
Oh, he's going to not use his Morrow Coil. Huh. That's slightly surprising to me.
Yeah, I mean, that Mortal Coil at only one damage isn't really that great about what Warrior is going to be. Isn't great against what Warrior is going to be playing at this point in the game, so.
It is the only removal in his hand other than Shadow Flame left.
Suppose.
So maybe he needs it in a certain, you know, if he gets in trouble at some point. He's thinking about playing the Lothop here, I think. I don't think Molten Giant. Yeah, just going to leave that there. He saw that his opponent had no way to deal with it the previous turn, so just going to leave it.
He's just waiting it out. He's just saying, all right. I'm going to make you use some of your removal on these two cards because I know you're running out of cards.
Yeah, and what removal do we... I mean, what could Matsune even have? I mean, yeah. He maybe has a bash if we've counted correctly. He has no Shield Slams. He has no Executes. Most of dealing with these minions involves running your face into them.
Pretty much.
And that doesn't feel good. Fiery War Axe just feels like a Fiery War Axe to your own face.
I mean... He could clear by going, he could go, well, he could have gone Grom Revenge. Now he's just going to go for a lot of armor.
Right.
And then, or he would have had to attack first into Mul'Ganis, and then Revenge because he'd be so low health. But never mind.
Well, there's Taraxis.
Decided to do that.
And he can play Taraxis and take zero damage from that Justicar. I think you just go for it, even though you're tossing away the Molten.
Yeah, I think that's pretty good.
Unless he's concerned about... Is he going to just Shadow Flame here?
I guess so. Okay.
I mean, Matsune continues to have no answer for this, so I suppose.
That's true. Playing the Lotheb and just 14 more damage in onto Matsune. Pinpingho just kind of taking the long, like, agonizing, grinding win over Matsune.
Right. Well, it's not going to be too agonizing for Matsune anymore. It's probably going to be concede here.
Yeah, I think so, too. There's really no way back from this. And, I mean, Matsune, after the qualifiers he went through, I think he can handle a long game like this.
All right, we have a Revenge, which is kind of like a Flame Strike at this point for 7 mana.
Yeah, but still not quite enough. He chooses Death, and so that's going to be the first win in the series for Pinpingho. So Pinpingho still alive for now.
Yep, well played there, and honestly, really good deck choice. It's something that, you know, a lot of players like to either bring comfort decks or bring, you know, decks that are good in the meta, but Pingping Ho says, you know what, I'm going to bring this old school deck, and it's going to work out great, just trust me.
Yeah, and excuse me, wow. And Matsun still needs that win with Warrior, but it's the kind of deck that you can get wins with. It's going to be one that at least is going to win most in, or win once in most best of fives, just because it's so solid, you know?
Yeah, that's a sign of a good deck when you know that it's not going to get swept too easily. I mean, back past, yeah, we've seen Control Warrior in the past get swept, but not this style of Warrior. I don't expect it to be, but, you know, Pingping Ho is a very strong player, so if anyone's going to do it, it's probably going to be him.
Yeah, and he's got kind of some crazy stuff coming. He's got that Murloc Paladin, and he's also got his own Warrior deck, too. So both of those decks, if you want to talk about decks that can beat Control Warrior, it's theoretically possible, although it might be. I feel like it's a little bit tougher for Murloc Paladin. How do you feel about that matchup?
It's an interesting matchup because it used to be the conventional wisdom that was that Murloc Paladin was such an overwhelming favorite. It was like 80-20 in people's minds. But, I mean, Control Warriors just learned how to play the matchup a lot better.
Yeah.
So now it's pretty even.
Yeah, kind of reminds me of Patron versus Handlock back in the day. It was really good for Handlock, but Patrons started figuring it out.
Exactly.
So, time to go into game number four between Matsun and Pingping Ho here on the Hearthstone Asia Pacific Winter Championship. And Matsun still just one win away. Just needs a win with this Warrior deck right now to move on to tomorrow. Pingping Ho needs to win this one to keep himself alive in the series. But even if he does lose this series, he's still not out of the tournament.
You know, I did mention that this matchup is around 50-50, but that's only if there are two brawls. And we didn't see two brawls, or we haven't yet.
I wonder. I mean, he's got that unstable ghoul in there, but I don't think you'd take out a brawl for an unstable ghoul. Well,
you could if you were very worried about aggro decks. I mean, we did see some, you know, tempo mage in the other group.
I guess. I feel like stuff like aggro shaman, though, and to a certain extent, tempo mage have kind of not been around enough to warrant unstable ghoul lately, but Matsun thinks otherwise. And to be fair, I mean, do you feel like you saw a lot more aggro in the Japanese qualifier? It could be just sort of a result of the meta within that system, within that server.
Yeah, I think he just did a lot of studying for this group. I mean, we saw Staz bring a very, you know, aggressive lineup, and we saw some other players as well bringing some aggressive lineups, like Zoo. I mean, we've seen a decent amount of Zoo so far, at least. I mean, you just casted the match with two Zoo players, so I mean, and Civil Ghoul in that matchup is pretty good.
I suppose. Pingping Ho dropping the Zombie Chow, he is going to be playing the Murloc Paladin deck this time around. Matsun, though, has an answer for that early minion.
So yeah, the name of the game for Matsun here, well, first of all, if he doesn't have two brawls, then he basically just has to go for a very aggressive stance. But if he does have two brawls, or maybe even a Deathwing, which, considering his battle rage, I doubt that's the case.
Probably not.
But if he has double brawl, then you basically get the Justicar out as quick as possible. You draw it as quickly as possible, as quickly as you can.
There you go. Hey. All right, well, that's pretty quick, yeah. All right, that's not bad. Second draw of the game. Gets the Justicar True Heart.
So basically, you tank up as much as possible, and your opponent Anyfins, and you survive it, and you brawl, and you kill it. And then they Anyfin again, and hopefully you have enough armor by then to survive that as well, and you second brawl, and you kill that, and then the game is over.
That's the idea. That's the plan of attack. Well, not really plan of attack. It's more like the plan of defend.
Yeah, exactly.
Matsun, not going to be attacking a whole lot this game.
So I suppose if you get the Golden Monkey very soon, then you could go for a more aggressive strategy. And
true.
You can't Quality Consecrate everything or Quality Pyro everything.
I always get so worried, though, when you play that early Golden Monkey, because it either goes really well or it goes really bad. You know, you can have those games where it's just like Foe Reaper 6,000 and that's about it.
Yeah. Matsun right in here hoping that this, or wanting this Doomsayer to actually have attack power so he can hurt himself, so he can battle rage.
I guess.
He could.
He could revenge.
He would have to use his face on the 1-1 first, and then revenge, and then battle rage just to get as many cards as possible, which is not the worst use, honestly. He might just battle rage for one, though. Looks like that's what he's going to do.
Okay. Yeah, just straight up cycling that card. 2 mana to draw a card. Gets the slam.
Yesterday, did you see Muster for Battle in Pingping Ho's deck?
I don't recall seeing it, no.
Okay.
Can't say for sure it's not in there, but I don't remember seeing it offhand.
Because
we saw Pingping Ho play that really long game against Sulky with this deck.
Right. And if he has Muster for Battle, then that would be a good reason to keep the revenge in hand if you're Matsuno.
Yeah, very true. And to be fair, we may not have seen all of his cards anyway yesterday, but we certainly saw most of them.
All right, so Matsuno picks up a shield slam here. That means he has two shield slams, obviously. And here's the thing. In this matchup, you don't want to take any damage. You want to get basically taking a few damage here and there could mean the difference between anything killing you or not. So we could see a shield slam on this Pyromancer here.
Yeah, I mean, there's not going to be a whole lot of other targets, and you can't really shield slam things too effectively after the anything can happen turn because you're probably not going to have a lot of armor.
Yeah, in the Japan preliminaries, we had a player by the name of Kag. He was able to, and there we see the shield slam. And he was able to defeat a Murloc Paladin with Control Warrior. He did have Deathwing, though, in his deck, so that's obviously something to keep in mind. But I think Matsuno, I mean, by bringing Control Warrior, and he also brought Murloc Paladin, I'm pretty sure he studied that game. Just to give him, basically give him a, you know, better idea of how this matchup plays out. And so I think that kind of helps him a bit here in being able to, you know, make the decisions like this to shield slam that Pyromancer.
So Pinpingo has some choices here, doesn't he? He's got the option to put down a Murloc War Leader and use his hero power. Is there a world where you just go for True Silver Champion and just try to keep them from building up that armor?
You could, but I think Pingping Ho is going for a very clear-cut strategy here, right? He's being mana efficient. He went for two mana creature and a hero power last turn. I think he's going to go for a war leader and hero power this turn. If not, a war leader and a war leader to turn them into 5/4s to make them difficult to kill.
Yeah. Might be better to wait for turn 6. Might just see the hero power pass.
That is true. We could just see hero power pass.
I think that's what we're going to see, actually. And yep. Yeah, didn't want to toss that Murloc War Leader out in front of that Fiery War Axe.
And any damage you do is, you know, damage that's going to matter in the long run.
Yeah.
And you're forcing Matsuno to use mana, or excuse me, use cards on not cards.
Hmm.
And obviously mana doesn't matter. I mean, in a lot of situations, you're fine with using cards on not cards as long as you're kind of getting a tempo advantage, but this game is all about value, right? It's all about, well, not really about value, but basically you're trying to get the combo here for Pingping Ho. Mm. And if you use up your removal as Matsuno on something that, or if you use it too early and you take damage from something else later, that can be problematic. But let's say Matsuno's not going to worry about it, just going to go for the Justicar right now.
Yep, might as well get it out. I mean, this can help clear some of those minions, unless your opponent has True Silver Champion. And more just being able to tank up from here on out for the rest of the game. That's going to be pretty big.
Absolutely. And the thing is, if he had revenge, he could have used the armor up, but now he gets to use the tank up, so this two damage that he's taking from these minions is pretty much irrelevant.
Yeah. And he can just revenge this if it ever gets out of hand. So draws into the slam, not too useful. Let's go for the Shield Maiden, I suppose. Gain some armor. You don't get to armor up if you do that, but...
Yeah, I think he wants to maximize his tank up. Right, so he wants to play the Shield Maiden on turn 8, as you know, given that you're able to do so. So I think we're gonna see a revenge and tank up right now. I think he wants to maximize that tank up as much as possible. And slam doesn't really make sense, obviously.
Yeah. Do you maybe want to wait until there's four Silverhand recruits out just to kill him when it's countering your tank up, quote unquote?
Well, I mean, if you're committing to tanking up every single turn, then you're committing to, you know, you're making sure that you get that 4 health every single turn. So allowing yourself to take 3 damage this turn is not the best.
Yeah. Can use that tank up. And uses that revenge. And so now over to Pinpingho. Solemn Vigil, he can draw a little bit if he wants to, but he's got 6 mana now. He's got 7 in total, so he could go for the double Murloc War Leader turn anytime he wants to, really. You think he's maybe waiting for something like a Bluegill Warrior, just to try to get as much damage. There we go, Bluegill Warrior.
That could be it. I mean, 6 damage out of the hand is pretty nice.
You might as well.
I mean, first anything, right?
Yeah.
You could just go for that. Maybe he's waiting for the second Bluegill. Just go for 12 damage right away.
Maybe. I feel like you can just go for the 6.
Right. I mean, we've been talking about how Warriors are figuring out how to play this matchup, but maybe Paladins are figuring out how to counter what the Warriors have been doing.
We'll see. He's got another Wild Pyromancer in his hand right now. And yeah, he can clear out this Shield Maiden with the Hero Power, with the Shield, with the, not Shielded Minibot, not in this game, with the Silverhand Recruit. There we go, yep. So he does successfully draw into the Bluegill Warrior. It's kind of cool. It deals with a lot of the armor.
Yeah, this is very powerful here from Pingping Ho.
Yeah, there is a brawl in the hand of Manson, though.
I almost guarantee he's not going to brawl this. Oh, there's the second brawl, so that answers our question.
Which does have two.
So Matsun can play the long game and go for the double brawl, but this is a very nice for Pingping Ho, and I think Matsun's just going to have to deal with this the hard way. I think we're going to see one shield slam and then bash on the other, though he might favor the draw.
We'll see.
He might favor double slam over bash just because he needs to draw something.
There's one shield slam. And so, yep, now he can take it out with his weapon. He can take it out with bash.
Did I say double slam over double bash over slam? I meant double slam over bash. Sorry.
Yeah, I knew what you meant. I think you said slam.
Okay.
Yeah. Don't worry. It's okay. You said the right thing.
Don't want Twitch chat to get mad at me. Anyway.
Forbid. Well, there's a bash. Okay. And so he only needs to lose two armor if he runs into that Bluegill Warrior.
Does he use a slam? I feel like, yeah, he needs that card draw.
Yeah, totally. Okay, so some Murlocs are loaded up for anything can happen now.
He could just go for six more damage, but I highly doubt Pingping Ho's going to do that.
Yeah.
All right, here we go. Solemn Vigil. Pick up two more cards. Maybe a cup of two silver.
Maybe play another Murloc. He draws into old Murkai. There's a second anything can happen. And the lay on hand. So he's got options to draw into what he needs to be to make these anything can happens very, very big. But Matsun has already had plenty of time to build up a lot more armor. No slam targets other than the Sludge Belcher, I guess. But you're not going to slam that. Going to have to use one of them on the Wild Pyromancer, I suppose.
Right. And he's going to go for the Sludge Belcher here. So this is kind of risky here for Matsun because you do want to have the Sludge Belcher after you brawl first so you minimize damage the next turn. But he's thinking that if I don't play this right now, I'm going to be just taking damage to the face every single turn. And double brawl is something you want to have eventually, but not right now.
Yeah. Okay, so Pingping Ho has a couple of ways you can deal with this. You can play the True Silver Champion, get through the first sort of life of Sludge Belcher with that and his Silverhand Recruit. Could also lay on hands after he does that, too. Or no, he couldn't if he plays the True Silver Champion.
Right.
Never mind. Yep.
By the way, if people are wondering why he, speaking of Pingping Ho, played double Pyromancer already, it's because he already has the Consecrate to be an Equality Activator. And he also figures that there's not too many situations where you need to use Equality plus Activator against Warrior anyway, so he's perfectly fine with it. He also needed, so in fact, he's going to use Equality here, it looks like. Hmm. But he wanted to be able to free his hand up to be able to use that Lay on Hands.
Yep, there's the Equality. Okay, he goes in. And what's it going to be?
Just Consecrate. Okay.
I was going to say, Consecrate. Yeah, he actually does go for it. Huh.
He's just removing, getting stuff out of his hand. He's saying, okay, my opponent has three cards, soon to be four. I just need to get this stuff out of my hand. There's not going to be any sort of, scary stuff coming my way. I need to just be able to lay on hands next turn.
He really, really wants to maximize the amount of Murlocs that are coming out of this. Anything can happen, it seems like.
Absolutely. I think he wants every single Murloc to come up before he does anything. That's why it's a pretty good pickup here.
Yeah. But while he's waiting so long, does that give Matsun too much time to build up armor?
Well, you'd rather have the full force of the Anyfin, I would say. And just kind of... He does have both Anyfins, and Lay on Hands only needs to pick up two more Murlocs to get the full, combo.
Yeah. All right, Lay on Hands. Let's see what he draws. Consecration. Empty Killbot. And Shielded Minibot. So no Murlocs. Does get the Shielded Minibot out there, though.
Yeah, Shielded Minibot's obviously very difficult for the Warrior to deal with normally, but it is a slam target now.
Yeah, there's a way that Matsun can cycle that slam, open up the Shielded Minibot to die from something a little bit later on. There's a Shield Block.
That is nice
cycling
for him. Shield Block is one of the best cards because he needs to cycle and he needs to get some armor as well.
So there's Grom Hellscream, and now Pingping Ho has to get through 54 health to win this game.
The funny thing
is... Oh, he does have Muster. Okay.
Yeah, there is the muster. The funny thing is that it's definitely possible with double any fit. It's
true.
It's not a health total that cannot be overcome.
Okay, so Pingping Ho electing to not really worry about the healing from the anti-Killbot, just wants more bodies on the board. He really wants Matsun to use that Death Spite now, it seems like.
Well, basically Pingping Ho knows that basically there's no brawls in Matsun's hand. I mean, there are. But they cannot be used. They absolutely cannot be used unless there's a Deathwing in the deck for some reason, or if he's teched in. But Pingping Ho knows that Matsune isn't allowed to brawl this, or else he'll lose the game.
Yep.
What now?
Can take a good amount of it out with the Death's Bite, at least. In fact, clear a lot of it.
Yeah, the thing is, Pingping Ho is playing this really well. It doesn't play the Muster for Battle. He just plays a lot of minions onto the board. He can play Muster for Battle after the Death's Bite is used. And, you know, does Matsune commit to the Bash here?
You know, what if you just clear down to just the Zombie Chow or something like that, you know, where you don't let them fill up their board with Murlocs. You kind of leave that there. It's going to heal if it comes out, or if it dies, rather.
I wonder if Matsune commits to the Grom here just to get something on the board. Yeah, it looks like he's going to. I wouldn't play it first, though. This is...
Okay, it's going to take some extra damage from that Death Spite at some point.
Oh, he's just going to not attack.
Yeah.
Interesting.
There's old a Murkai. All right, that's good to see.
A very big draw for Pingping Ho here.
And I feel like Pingping Ho is kind of compelled to get rid of some of the minions on his own board because he needs to make room for Murlocs, doesn't he?
Yeah, absolutely true.
Kind of a weird position to be in.
The funny thing is that Zombie Chow has no downside right now. It's just clearing armor.
Yep.
So Murakai is going to hit the field, it looks like. Otherwise, Pingping Ho is not really doing anything. There's no reason to use the Equality. You might as well just throw your minions in here. I guess he could use his face with the True Silver. He could actually go True Silver, old Murakai, trade in this shield and mini bot, and then just throw everything else to face, make it do. That is really annoying for Matsune to deal with.
Yeah. See if Pingping Ho decides to go with it. How he decides to deal with the Grom Hellscream.
I mean, Pingping Ho's not worried about taking 10 damage. This is the only burst in the warrior arsenal, is this Grom. So, Pingping Ho, I'm pretty sure he's fine taking 10 damage here. Looks like he is going to go for that.
No problem. And then just a bit more damage to face, just something to clear the armor with.
Yeah, definitely. I think I would have preferred to see the Murakai stay alive, because Matsune can't just let that sit there anyway.
Yeah. I mean, if he would have used the 2 damage from the Zombie Chow instead, then he would have been able to make sure that Zombie Chow didn't benefit Matsune at all, too.
Yep. There's an Acolyte. That's a pretty good draw for Matsune here.
Yeah.
Absolutely what he wants to see.
Play that, and then use that Death Spite.
Yeah, at this point, you pretty much have to use your Death Spite here. I wonder if he commits to Revenge just to kill off the Shield Minibot and give his Acolyte an extra draw. That would be pretty poor, we can see from the hand of Pingping Ho. Oh, he might go for it now, though. Oh, yeah, he's definitely going to go for it. Okay, here we go.
Oh, yeah.
And if Pingping Ho goes for the Muster for Battle, he's overriding his True Silver Champion, which is very important.
He doesn't go for it, though.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Oh.
And there's a Bluegill Warrior. Okay, so between Bluegill Warrior and Muster for Battle, he can clear this board. He can do it with Consecration as well.
Well, he can clear the board with just his True Silver.
Yeah, that's true. But do you think it's good to just get that Bluegill Warrior out there just so that it comes back again?
Yeah, I think so. Just go, I mean, if I were Pingping Ho here, I just kill off the Acolyte on the right, kill off the Acolyte on the left with the Shield Mini Bot. Well, I guess with the Bluegill, he might as well, right?
Yeah.
You don't have any more buffs in your deck anyway, other than the Anyfin. And then you throw the Mini Bot to the face, you make a Hero Power, and then you send that Muster for Battle. The one problem is that your opponent might have Harrison and be able to get a lot of cards out of it.
So that's just a risk he'll have to take, D2.
Well, if he feels like he's far ahead enough that he can just finish his opponent right now, then maybe that's a risk he doesn't want to take.
Move quickly.
But
either way, he's got to move quick. Got to make a choice. Pingping Ho, thinking through his options, looks like he's going to toss out that Bluegill Warrior. Make that Anything Can Happen just a little bit more powerful.
Oh, Consecrate.
Yeah, going for the Consecration.
Oh,
Equality Consecration even. Yeah, denying as many draws as he can for Matsune. Denies one this way, I suppose.
Yeah, he could have just used his True Silver, but I mean, if he's correctly identified that this is just Removal Warrior, so I mean, he's not going to need the Equality in the future, most likely. So he just gets enough stuff on the board to, you know, deal with his opponent.
Yeah, he's playing this in a really annoying way for Matsune to deal with. There's Elise Starseeker finally coming into the hand of our warrior player. Revenge used.
And Pingping Ho didn't Hero Power last turn.
Yeah,
I suppose he really just wanted to do the Anything Can Happen and be able to get the. He can get, you know, 5 out last turn anyway, so it would have worked regardless.
Yeah.
So here we go. Anything can happen. First one comes out. That's 22 damage to the face.
Yep, that's right. 10 plus 6 plus 6. And he's just going to end his turn. Now Matsune Compelled to brawl.
Ooh, gets the Sludge Belcher. That is absolutely huge.
Yeah, now he can brawl and put the Sludge Belcher down afterwards. Really make it hard for Pimpingho to make that follow-up turn work.
You know what is really interesting? So, like, I'm looking at the sidebar here. Monsoon used Revenge, Elise, and Tank Up Last Turn. He could have equipped the Fire War Axe. That would have been very, very useful right now.
That's a good point.
Because he could have used Brawl, taken care of the last remaining Murloc, and then put the Sludge Belcher down as well.
I think he's kind of realizing that, judging by the look on his face. Let's see what comes out of the Brawl. If it's Elise Starseeker, that's great.
He didn't attack first, by the way. Just throwing that out there, but...
Nope.
Oh, the worst one.
Wow. And yeah, he didn't attack first. I mean, that alone makes you wonder.
Yeah, it doesn't really matter too much, but...
Would have been three damage.
I think if he kills... I think if he doesn't play Sludge Belcher, he's dead.
Yeah. Probably. This Murloc deck, man. Pimpingo's Murloc deck just breaks people. Broke Sogi yesterday.
Even when your opponent's playing Murloc.
I know, right?
So I think unless Pimpingho gets extraordinarily unlucky with this, he's going to have lethal here. I mean, it's 22 last time. It's going to be well over 29, I believe, here.
I think it should be good. We'll see. So yeah. 29 is the health to beat. Can Pimpingho do it?
There might not be no combination that doesn't do it.
Yeah,
so.
I was going to say, that is more than enough, way more than enough for Pimpingho to do it. And we are going to go to game five. Pimpingho ties up the series. We're going to go to a Warrior versus Warrior final.
Absolutely insane. I mean, this match has gone on so long, and it's going to be culminating in one of the longest matchups with this Warrior versus Warrior.
I know. It's a long meta. It's a long meta right now.
By the way, I'm happy about it. I mean, for those viewers out there thinking that I'm complaining about this is awesome. All these games, I mean, so many decisions to be made. Mm. I like it.
You're not selling it to me. I don't feel the emotion. One more time with feeling.
I love these long games.
There you go. Okay, I believed it that time. So, speaking of long games, we've come a long way, but we're getting to game five now between Mattson and Pimpingho. It's going to be a Warrior showdown, and the winner moves on to tomorrow. The loser, well, they also move on to tomorrow, but not in quite as glorious of a way. Either way,
they get out of the group.
Sticking around. That's right. The winner gets out of their group. That's the main thing, so you can do it. Who's your money on?
My money, I got to... Just got to go against my countrymen. I got to go with Pimpingho.
Wow. All right. I think I got to agree. I think Pimpingho has been playing this one just a little bit better. But I'm not going to say it. I was going to say anything can happen. I'm not going to say it. I'm not going to say it in that context. We're going in to the next match very, very soon between Pimpingho and Mattson. A huge game for both of these guys. One of them moves out of their group in first place, doesn't need to worry about playing that extra best of five. The other one goes down to the lower bracket in their group and has to worry about staying alive tomorrow.
Absolutely. A lot of nerves in that decider match. And if you can just get out of the group right now, pick up that extra prize money, be two matches away from securing the Asia Pacific Championship. That's obviously where you want to be.
It's very, very big. So, here we go. What do you keep?
As Mattson, you keep that Elise for sure.
Definitely. I agree. You've got the coin as well. You can get that out on turn three.
I mean, as much removal as the Warrior has, we saw it, you know, against the Handlock. You run out of removal if there's too many threats.
True.
So if Mattson can get out that Golden Monkey early enough, then that can be problematic. On the other side, Pimpingho does pick up the Justicar in his opening hand, so if this goes to Fatigue, he has a major advantage.
That is true. Well, Mattson can just pass the turn again if he wants to.
Yeah, no use using the coin here for a Fire War Axe or an armor up.
Yeah. Take some time to think about it, though. And he will.
He's thinking about future turns here.
Yeah, of course. That's what you got to do. I mean, that's the thing with these early turns. It's better in a match like this to take some time and sort of formulate your plan for the next 5-6 turns. Kind of like get a rough idea of what you want to get done in this game, how you want to approach the matchup.
Absolutely.
And without the threat of Harrison Jones, yeah, you might as well go ahead and play that Fiery War Axe.
And the thing is, Mattson, I mean, he's playing this Fire War Axe out, and this shows to me that he wants to take a very aggressive stance in this game as well. We've seen it. We saw it yesterday. He went very aggressive, you know, playing the control decks against, you know, other decks that basically he needed to be the beatdown in that situation, right? So looks like he's, you know, going for that same strategy. Because if he just sits back, maybe he just loses the fatigue game, particularly because he has those Battle Rages in his deck.
That's right. A little bit of damage coming in to reduce the armor, and it will be the coin into Elise Starseeker. Wanted to get that damage in because he didn't want his opponent to be able to, like, armor up, shield slam Elise too easily next turn.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So, Ping Ping Ho, the only way he can deal this right now is to use Revenge and Execute.
Seems like a little bit excessive to take out Elise Starseeker, doesn't it? Or maybe not. Maybe I'm wrong.
I mean, from Ping Ping's whole perspective, I mean, we saw it last game, right? He went for an Equality Consecrate on two Acolytes of Pain. And so he's not worried about the threats in Monson's deck. He says that, you know, I'm just going to wear you out and go to Fatigue, and hopefully you don't draw the monkey in time.
Yep.
Yeah, and the way Monson has played this, I expect the shield block to come out.
Yeah, he likes the cycle.
Yeah, he's not. Well, in earlier games, it was kind of a different reason, I would say, for cycling. Here, he's just saying, you know, there's no way I'm going to try to play this Fatigue. I'm just going to try to be as aggressive as possible.
Right.
And Ping Ping Ho, if he doesn't play an Acolyte of Pain, that will show how he intends to play this match out, which is basically he wants to win the Fatigue definitely.
He's thinking about it right now.
Yeah, he's counting the cards.
Formulating his game plan.
He's you know, counting to see how many cards are left for his opponent, how many cards are left for him. And looks like he's decided that even after playing his Acolyte of Pain, he'll still be ahead, quote-unquote, in the Fatigue race, which means he'll be fatiguing later than his opponent.
I suppose. Sludge Belcher drop down for Matson.
Yep. And going to hit the face, get rid of that armor once more instead of hitting that Acolyte.
Yeah. Really making sure that the shield slams have the least value possible. There's the Elise Starseeker now for Ping Ping Ho.
And there could be some, you know, mind games here going on, or at least kind of next level thinking.
Yeah.
Monsoon, maybe he reads into the fact that Ping Ping Ho wants to play this to Fatigue, and so therefore Ping Ping Ho just wants to cycle this once. And so he says, why am I going to kill this Acolyte when my opponent wants that anyway?
Could be.
Might as well just hit the face.
True. And, yep, he's going to prioritize the Justicar too hard. Again, getting that tank up started as soon as possible is the way to win the Fatigue battle, which I've got a feeling we're going to be going to Fatigue on this one, which means that we're going to see Golden Monkey drawn by presumably both players at some point.
Right. And
maybe
I mean,
not at the point where they have any cards
I
left.
Think it might go to Fatigue, but I think that definitely the way Monson's playing, he's going to not want to win via Fatigue at all. Going to try to end this as quickly as possible, I would say. So, we have a few options to deal with this Justicar True Heart. Depends on what Monson wants to go with. Honestly, going for the shield slam wouldn't be too bad, but also going for the fireworks. I mean, again, he's not worried about his health. He's not playing the Fatigue game at all, I don't think.
Yep, just going to use that second shield block now. And continue cycling through his deck.
There's the map. That is very important.
Yeah, he gets it pretty early. Now we'll see if he can get the Golden Monkey early.
By the way, we missed this, but Elise Starseeker picked up here for Ping Ping Ho.
Yeah. No, I mentioned it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Way to listen to me, D2. Jeez.
I was too focused on the game.
Makes sense. Okay, so Gore Howl in the hand of Ping Ping Ho. Do you play it right now to get rid of the Sludge Belcher? Do you just drop your own Elise? Maybe. Shield Maiden, Shield Slam. Could do that too.
Thing is, Ping Ping Ho has a lot to think about, right? Because he sees Matsun being so aggressive. So, do you go for the value here and get, you know, greedy with your own Gore Howl? Or do you start playing a bit more defensive and try to hold off the aggression here from Matsun? But, I mean, Gore Howl at this moment, you're not going to die anytime soon, so I think you just go for Gore Howl here.
Might as well. Do you feel like you have to answer the aggressive drawing of Matsun with drawing of your own?
This is a clear indication that Ping Ping Ho doesn't want to draw too much.
I guess so. All right, so there's Gore Howl. He will go for that. Matsun, though.
I expect this map to come flying out of Matsun's hand.
Oh, yeah.
Considering how he's been playing so far.
Definitely.
And the Justicar. Well, he could Justicar or Tank up. That changes a bit.
Yeah, you may want to wait a turn with the map.
I guess he can't Tank up this turn.
I don't think it hurts you too much to wait with the map, does it?
You could go for the tempo play of going for the Shield Maiden first, just to put some pressure on your opponent, and then go for the map.
It's true. I mean, you are right that if he plays Justicar, he can't use it right away. So in that case, there's not really a big reason to play it this turn.
Yeah, he looks like he's going to go for the Shield Maiden, go for the biggest thing. Hopefully he can get in some damage with it.
Yeah.
And I mean, the problem with playing the map, obviously, is that you map and then nothing.
Right.
Hero Power, which is not... Matsun is clearly not concerned with Hero Power, right? Right, he wants to kill his opponent as quickly as possible.
Yep, seems that way. throwing out that Shield Maiden, getting that 5-5 body on the board, and it's not Brawl time, probably.
I want to stop and just talk about how these players are going for completely opposite strategies, and a lot of the time you see Control Warrior versus Control Warrior, it's just tank up, tank up, tank up, tank up the entire time. And this is so much more refreshing, in my opinion. They're basically going for complete opposite strategies. Ping Ping Ho is trying to defend. Matsun's trying to, you know, be aggressive in this matchup. And it's really cool to see, honestly.
Yeah. Well, it kind of defeats the argument where it's like, well, there's only one style to play each deck.
Yeah.
And in this mirror matchup, I suppose you get a little bit more flexibility about how you want to play it. But
especially with the Lease.
Yeah. It's, but you can really, yeah, you can definitely do some adjusting. That's for sure.
All right, so Ping Ping Ho has a few ways to deal with this Shield Maiden. He's trying to think of the best one here.
Looks like Shield Slam is going to be it.
Yeah, and that's pretty painful for Matsun because he can't just go for, you know, Justicar into map here. He needs to actually deal with the Shield Maiden or else, you know, his Justicar gets killed by the Gore Howl and then he's taking 5 damage a turn.
Going to go for the map anyway.
All right, well, he's going to go for the map. He might not go for the Shield Slam. But looks like he's going to go for a slam, just a cycle here. He wants to cycle as hard as possible for that Golden Monkey.
He wants that Golden Monkey real bad. Gets the Unstable Ghoul, though. But that's one of those cards you can kind of hold on to and turn into a Legendary later. So that's not that bad.
Absolutely. I think he's just going to hold on to that for as long as possible. The question is, the question for Matsun is, how many cards does he hold on to for the prospect of turning them into Legendaries? And how many cards does he cycle so that he can get to the Golden Monkey faster?
That's always the tricky part when you're playing these Elise decks is how much of a priority you put on keeping cards in your hand. With that attack though, that's kind of tells us right there what he thinks about it. He wants to keep everything he can.
Right. And it makes sense in another way too. I mean, he's obviously not worried about his own life total, so you might as well, you know, save those executes anyway if you have the opportunity to.
Okay, so Elise Starseeker comes out. Map is going into Ping Ping Ho's deck. Might see double Golden Monkey. We'll see. What's the draw? Shield Slam. I'm like excited every draw now. I'm like, is it Golden Monkey?
I mean, I'm excited too. Looks like we're probably going to see the Shield Slam as well as the Justicar into tank up, I would imagine. Oh, is he reaching for that Grommish?
Whoa, wow.
Going for the Grommish.
Really aggro. He's
going to get that damage in.
Yep. Harrison Jones. Now, can you kill Grommish with what is there? I guess Bash, Revenge, Gore Howl would do it.
In the reverse order.
Yeah.
But yeah, that would do it. And
those cards together. That's what I'm saying, DJ.
All right. He could also use the Acolyte first and then Revenge, considering that, I mean, he sees Matsun getting extremely aggressive. So if you're Ping Ping Ho, I don't think this is going to fatigue. Yeah. It could, but you might as well get on the same page as far as, you know, keeping up with him with card draw.
Yep. So get in there with the Gore Howl first before Grommish gets really angry. Make him angry.
All right.
Then bash him. It's like a fighting game combo being done to Grommish right now.
Gore Howl into bash into revenge.
Gore Howl can't survive that, man. That's 100% damage combo. Gotta nerf that, man.
Oh, my goodness.
And okay, Deathspite comes in. He still hasn't played that Justicar Trueheart yet.
Not yet.
Yeah.
He could play it with the Deathspite here.
He could.
He could also execute this Acolyte.
He could also just go for a big armor turn, too, with Justicar.
Yeah, but again, that's not really Matsun's, you know, what he's trying to do this game.
True.
He's deciding between executing and denying the card draw. I mean, considering his opponent has 4, soon to be 5, maybe 6, depending on, you know, how many card draws you give to the Acolyte. It's pretty valuable here to deny that card draw. And yeah, I kind of like it, honestly.
Okay, there's the execute, yep. Gonna throw
playing
the
Death Spite can be problematic, though, especially, I mean, he just denied the card draw, but then the Harrison's gonna come out, which is gonna be painful here for Matsun.
Yep, Harrison Jones, you just see that big silly grin. And Harrison Jones is actually like holding the Golden Monkey in that card, too. Or it kind of looks like it. No, I guess it's not. I guess on the bottom left corner, it looked like the Golden Monkey, but it wasn't.
Right, and you see the pain in Matsun's face. He had a clear strategy of denying card draw to his opponent. And now Ping Ping Ho is just going to play out that shield block. He knows what's up. He knows that Matsun's playing very aggressive. This is completely turned. I mean, Ping Ping Ho was definitely going for the fatigue game early on, but has flipped 180.
Yeah. There's another bash. Okay, so he can deal with Harrison.
Without using a premium removal like that, Steel Slam.
Yep, that's right. And he can also hold on to those cheap cards for legendaries, too, when he draws a gold monkey.
Is he holding on to Justicar for another legendary?
I don't think that would be a good idea. I mean, isn't Justicar, like, really important if you're going to go long game? Because his plan isn't working, right?
Right.
He's not going to be able to kill Pinpingho like he wanted to. I think it's just kind of hard to do that in any situation in this mirror matchup, but...
Maybe he's just worried about the Gorehell. I think it's at still 3 attack?
Hard to tell. 3 or 4, yeah.
It has enough, pretty much. I don't think he's killed 5 things.
Yeah. But how else are you going to get rid of any of that armor, you know?
It's true.
Fatigue, I guess. I don't know.
Many, many legendaries.
Yeah, that's the idea.
All right, Matsu not looking too good. This is the face that I saw at the Japan preliminaries as well. Maybe he's feeling a little bit jet-lagged here.
I remember the VOD. Just kind of shaking his head, but just not being willing to play that Justicar 2 art. And so the Gorehall does still have 4 attack on it. Pimpingo just taking a big edge in this game. And the other kind of unfortunate thing for Matsu, too, is that by having to use this removal now on minions, he's reducing all the legendaries that he's going to get.
Yeah, absolutely. You can see it kind of pains him to be able to have to do that.
Yeah. Probably should. And Gold Monkey, nope. Revenge.
Revenge is not what you want at all. Revenge is a card you want to turn into a legendary.
Yep.
Which kind of shows its worth or lack thereof.
Okay. Might finally be time for Justicar here. Matsu looking like he's really having trouble deciding, though.
And the thing is, when you're kind of agonizing or over a decision like this, I mean, Pinpingho can see this. So now Pinpingho's gaining confidence.
Yeah, for sure. Well, there goes the Shield Slam. Can't really blame him. Feel like you kind of have to do it. And he is actually going to play the Justicar. So he realizes now he needs the armor. And you know, to be fair, he's got more health in total. He's doing a little bit better on that count. It's a Deathlord for Pinpingho.
Ooh, Deathlord is very big here. Basically, Matsun cannot kill that until he gets the Golden Monkey.
I was going to say, yeah, you can't have the Golden Monkey coming out automatically because then you don't get the legendaries.
I wonder if we'll see something crazy like Pinpingho killing off his own Deathlord.
Might not be the worst idea.
Yeah, he's not even going to deal with this Justicar. He says, you know what?
Huh, interesting.
I think he's going to slam it next turn. I think he's going to slam his own Deathlord and try to get out the monkey.
Probably. I mean, if nothing else, he can brawl, too. That's the thing, is the more minions Matsun plays right now, the more that brawl might get rid of that Deathlord and bring out the Golden Monkey.
I think we're going to see a huge Battle Rage turn here.
That's the idea. He wants to either draw a lot of cards and then...
Hopefully he gets the Golden Monkey for his sake, and then he can just execute this Deathlord and not have to worry about it.
Yep, that's the idea. Bash, 2 more. Brawl, and he doesn't get the Golden Monkey. He can't kill that Deathlord yet.
And now Pinpingho doesn't even need to use his own slam. He can just kill off his Deathlord by running it into the Justicar.
Yeah. Yeah, just attack the Unstable Ghoul with the Death Spite first and run the Deathlord in.
That would be very painful to just see that Golden Monkey come off that Deathlord.
You know, the thing is that with the minions that have come out of Matsun's hand, especially with that... Battle Rage, I think we may likely see that.
There's a second Deathlord.
Dude, Matsun's in big trouble. We might see a Golden Monkey, but not in the way we wanted to this game, and not in the way that Matsun wanted to either.
Not at all. All right, here we go. He's going to sacrifice that.
There's the monkey!
Oh, my God.
Man.
Heart palpitations for Matsun there.
That was so close. Oh man. And now Matsun has a big hand to play this Golden Monkey from.
Absolutely. He can draw a card and play the Golden Monkey, get all the options into his hand.
Man, talk about cutting it close, right? That last draw before the Deathlord Deathrattle brings a minion out, gets him the Golden Monkey. He's going to get one more draw for one more legendary, execute the Deathlord just to get that out of the way.
What do you think about Slam instead of the execute in order to just draw a card right now? How deep are we into
I mean, you're kind of exchanging, right?
How deep are we into Matsun's deck?
I don't know.
All right, so probably makes like sense to play this.
Eight left?
Yeah, about that much.
What's
makes sense for the Belcher to come out.
Oh, that Chilma, or that Ice Howl, rather, might be good at killing off some minions later.
Yeah, good for removal.
Storm Rage, Bolt, Dragon.
The Belcher is a guaranteed solid minion. That's why Matsun went for that rather than going for Legendary.
Gruul is something that could potentially be big. Even Van Cleef, depending on how you play it. There's a Brawl.
This is pretty important, although these are all pretty big minions to begin with. So
it does okay. Does okay with it. He can kill, I mean, he can slam the slime. Slam the slime. That sounds like an advertisement for an energy drink for sure. And then he can kill the shield bane off by just attacking it, so he still gets a board clear.
Right, but Ping Ping Ho has two weapons and a Grommash in hand.
He does. Yeah, he does. But Edson has a way to handle the
Grommash. Okay, never mind. He was very far into his deck. There's another Storm Rage.
That is Anubarak.
Anubarak is very good.
That is a very, very good draw.
There's Syncmaster Overspark as well. We're introducing you to all the legendaries that aren't typically played. There's the map for Ping Ping Ho.
Is he going to draw right into it? No.
There's a Shield Slam. Shield Slam is pretty good in this situation right here, but...
Is it, though? Because you still have a 4-4 to deal with.
You do still have a 4-4 to deal with.
I mean, he can't even Shield Slam and then play Grommash Hellscream.
He can Shield Slam and Deathbite, but then you're overriding your Fiery War Axe.
Yeah, and you haven't used any charges of it yet, too.
You know what the thing is? Even if Ping Ping Ho picks up that monkey, he's only getting about one or two legendaries a turn.
Yeah. That is true. His hand is much smaller.
Wow.
What an insane end of this series, dude. This game is out of control. All right.
Absolutely. So how afraid is Matsun of Brawl? But he has a Anubarak, so he can just play into Brawl.
Yeah, exactly.
It doesn't even matter to him. It doesn't matter that much.
Yeah, it doesn't really make a big difference.
So the one thing he cannot do is play the Thinkmaster over Spark. That's one thing he can't do.
Matsun is out of cards now. It gets Malygos too.
I think
not the most helpful, but it is a high health minion. It's hard to get rid of.
Absolutely. I think we're going to see the Illidan into the Edwin.
Yeah, that would make sense.
But again, the one thing he should never play is the Thinkmaster ever in this game, unless he only has a 4-4 on board and, you know, maybe you just play it out. But
the funny thing is that he can use the Thinkmaster Overspark to try to turn Illidan's minions into bigger ones.
Yeah, but...
It's random now.
It's random. It's random, so you don't want to turn that Anubarak. All right, we got some power on the board. There's no Brawl here from Ping Ping Ho.
Wow. And I think Illidan's right this time. I don't think Ping Ping Ho is prepared for this.
Not at all prepared. There's an Execute, some removal in the hand for Ping Ping Ho, but no activator other than Grom.
Oh, man. Ping Ping Ho is head in his hands now. Wow. He's like, how did this happen?
This game
turned
around.
I was not prepared.
This game turned around so completely.
Seriously. I mean, just a great Battle Rage. And we criticize that Battle Rage in his deck. It's just not something you see in Control Warrior. But at the end of the day, that's what allowed him to get so many cards in his hand to turn into all these legendaries.
And the funny thing is, Matsun from the very beginning went for that aggressive strategy. And it took Ping Ping Ho a couple turns to catch up and realize, I need to go for this too. And now he's just running low on cards.
Yeah. What do you do? Do you use Grommash to kill off Van Cleef then?
Maybe. He's gonna Deathbite, which means he's, you know, just basically getting rid of that charge.
Yeah. Okay. Gonna use that on Van Cleef.
The tank up is very valuable here. And Grom is now able to be activated.
Yep.
So he might see some. Okay, Gruul coming out here.
Dude, Gruul is very scary.
Gruul is indeed very scary.
He's gonna get very executed too, but.
I think Ping Ping Ho is going face with Grom here if he doesn't pick up anything. There's a Bash.
Okay, Bash is nice.
I think the plan is Ping Ping Ho is going to play this Grom, hit the face with this Death Bite, execute the Gruul. Maybe he kills the Anub, actually.
I mean, Anub's just going to come back, and you're going to have a 4-4 there. I think you got to kill the Gruul.
But he's going to execute the Gruul. He's going to hit the face with the Grom, I think.
Oh, okay. Yeah, with the Grom. I thought you meant to kill the Anubarak with the Execute.
Yeah. No, he's going to kill the Grom. The Gruul.
Too many legendaries. Grommash, it's getting to be a little bit too much.
Oh, and this Ice Howl could be very valuable here.
Yep. Ice Howl, the card that was revealed by Papa Smithy and I on our stream at OGN.
Oh,
making
very
a
nice.
Big difference, finally, in this game.
Finally.
Yep. Finally.
Actually,
yeah, that's right. That's true. Finally, he's useful.
Matsun could actually trade in his Anubarak and then play the Thinkmaster Overspark and then the Bolvar.
It's true, I suppose.
Because the 4-4, if it turns into 1-1, it's not the end of the world. And you still get two minions on the board as well.
You really want that 4-4, though, to stick around, don't you? What
now? Yeah, but right now, if he uses the Ice Hell to trade into the Grom, then his Anubarak could die to the Bash that we see in Ping Ping Ho's hand.
See, the tricky part when you're in this Golden Monkey scenario is that you're going to have a lot of 9-mana minions that doesn't let you use your hero power. Right. So sometimes it gets to the point where you just, you know, simply can't use the
hero power that's going to
keep you alive. Yeah. Wow, just playing him again, just going for tons of damage.
I kind of like it, actually. I mean, you're foregoing the 8 attack right now, but...
Is the Golden Monkey literally the last card in his deck? That poor guy. I know how you feel. Happens to me on ladder all the time, Pinpingho. I know how you feel, man.
That would be pretty painful.
It is. It is.
All right, well, uses all of his mana, does Pinpingho, is able to take out this Nerubian.
Now, the fatigue damage is mounting for Matson.
It is, but he needs to just play stuff as quickly as possible.
Yeah. Bolvar Four Dragon is getting very large.
Yeah, it's Bolvar time.
It is Bolvar time. He's an 11-7. Look at that.
11-7, let's do it.
And Pinpingho's like, oh no, my life is a living nightmare. And Bolvar still lets Matson armor up too, which is crucial.
Oh!
Big Game Hunter! I mean, it gets rid of one of them, right?
Yeah, but that's... It trades with a Anubarak too!
It does. That actually could be pretty big. 4 damage now for Matson.
I think it's Ice Hall time, honestly, just to protect your Anubarak.
I agree. And then you know that the Golden Monkey is going to be coming soon, so you want that 10-10 on the board to deal with whatever's going to come next.
And definitely.
Yeah, you give up your armor up this turn, but might as well go for it.
So all right, here we go.
There's Ice Howl taking
8 more damage to the face.
Golden Monkey. A little bit late to the party.
Well, that's the value of Ice Howl here, right? You get to be able to play that.
That's right. Okay.
This is coming. 5 damage of fatigue. He needs to still play the Malagos, though.
Well, yeah, I suppose you do. I mean, he can cut the damage he's taking by a lot,
He's doing 4 damage to his opponent every turn. It would be very nice to do 8 damage instead.
Yeah.
I just don't think... I mean, doing 4 damage every turn, but taking...
It's not going to be enough,
then
is
3,
it?
Then 4, yeah, every single turn. It's just not going to work out for Matsu.
I think you're right. I think you need to play the Malagos here. And he thinks so, too. Okay. Only that Tinkmaster Overspark remains. Pimping out, what legendary will he draw?
Ysera!
That could be...
But he
he
can't tank up, though.
That's right. He can't gain that armor, and he's going to lose so much health now.
Ysera Awakens, that could be a huge card.
That could be really big. 6 damage by Matson.
14.
All right.
Awakens is lethal if Ysera doesn't die.
Yeah, and Ysera could die. Matson deciding right now, can he take the time to kill this Ysera and still live? I don't know. I don't know. I don't think he can.
I think it's time for a YOLO Tinkmaster Overspark. I mean, 2 cards kill you.
I think you're
right. Nightmare and Ysera's Awakens both kill you.
I think you're absolutely right.
If you leave that up there.
I think it's all down to Tinkmaster Overspark. I mean, if you play it and it transforms Ysera into a 1-1.
That's game winning.
Well, next turn you're taking 7 damage. You take, 3 really as a result of that.
And so even if it's an Emerald Drake, do you?
No.
You don't even.
10.
You don't win in 2 turns, do you?
I don't think so.
I think he's gonna go. No.
He's gonna go for it. Stinkmaster time. Tinkmaster time. He's got to hit the Ysera. He's got to turn into a 1-1.
Here we go.
Does he do it, Matson?
He's not happy with it. And it turns his Anubarak into a squirrel. And that is going to be it. Pinpingho.
Oh, man. He can destroy that beast, too. Use the Hemet Nesting Wary. Come on, swag Hemet Nesting Wary. Destroy the squirrel. You got to do it. Hashtag destroy the squirrel.
He's counting 1,000 times over, making sure that he has a lethal here.
Oh, it's easy lethal, man. When that fatigue comes in, that's going to be it. Pinpingho has won this match in a thrilling 3-2 victory. Ysera Awakens going to seal the deal. He could have gone for the swag Hemet Nesting Wary. I'm a little bit disappointed there, but not as disappointed as Matsun, man. He's not out of the tournament. But he's not winning this match.
Gives his opponent a nice applause there at the end as the game finished up. We have our winner after a grueling 5-game series. Pinpingho will be moving on. Matsun moves down to the
literally grueling. We saw gruel in that game.
Literally grueling. We did see gruel in that match.
That was crazy. That was an insane best of 5, wasn't it?
It was pretty insane. We have on our prompter, it says quick recap of game. How do you
recap that game? I'm just going to refuse a teleprompter. No, sorry. There's a lot going on.
There was so much going on.
Scroll it off the screen there. No, it's okay. But that was crazy. I mean, we thought for a second there that Matsun really had it, right? Because he had that Golden Monkey earlier. He had so many legendaries. He had so much going for him, but in the end, the fatigue just was a little bit too much. He couldn't use his hero power, couldn't get that armor.
Absolutely, and I thought that he might have had to use that Tinkmaster Overspark, as we do see Pingpingho moving on. He is out of Group B there.
Yep.
Matsu moves down to face the winner of Naviut and Sogi.
That's right. So, man, I could talk about those games all day, but we got to send it over to Frodan, who's standing by at the fireside with Pingpingho.
Thank you very much, Joa, and D2, a job well done casting that series. Pingpingho, you took a really grueling series. How are you feeling right now, having won this crazy control battles between you and Matsun?
Well, it was pretty tough. It's like, I'm not very confident with my warriors, actually. It's like, I haven't practiced with a lot, so, yeah. I'm happy that I can win.
Now that you're in the top four, and you've advanced first in your group, you've been really confident all weekend. Does this really solidify your confidence that you're going to win this tournament?
Sure, I think so. Yeah.
Wow, you're so confident in the interviews, and then at least when we're talking to you over there before the tournament, and then when the tournament begins, I think right now everything's just sinking in. Let's go ahead and break down that series. You were down 0-2, and then all of a sudden had to come back. What did you say to yourself to really pull yourself back mentally?
Actually, it's because my lineup was major build to beat Warrior, so I actually didn't feel that far behind. Yeah, I think as long as he has a Warrior, I have a chance.
Awesome. Well, I guess in the end, it came down to a lot of crazy stuff. The Golden Monkey things, it felt like it was a lot of panic. There was one moment at the very final end where we might have seen Hemant Nesting Wary legitimately kill a beast on the squirrel. Why didn't you do it, man?
Didn't have, like, the brain power to think about it.
Right. You didn't even realize that that was a possibility, right?
Actually, I did think about it. I actually realized I can kill it, but I didn't really, like, I was too busy counting the lethal. Like.
All right, well, don't worry, man. Take a break. You did a hell of a job to win that series. We're done here. Pingpingho needs a break, so let's send it over to TJ, Papasmithy, and Kibler, who are standing by to break down this match.
Thanks very much, Dan. And what a match it was. 2 hours later, many control matchups later. Papasmithy, we're going to go right into the deep analysis
here. All right.
What do you think of the Golden Monkey?
I mean, the Golden Monkey just warps the game in the best possible way. We thought the Anubarak, because remember, there were so many legendaries in the hand of Matsun so early. The Anubarak looked like it was the ultimate value choice, but that Ysera just warped the game right at the last moment.
Yeah, and Kibler, control warrior mirrors have gotten pretty interesting over the past couple months.
Yeah, we used to, you know, sort of spam Resident Sleeper in chat when it was control warrior, but it comes down to things like that, you know, the game ending with Anubarak versus Ysera, and oh, it's awesome. I love those kind of games.
All right, well, we have a nice little clip here of that pretty much sums up the series, so why don't we bring that up right now?
Yep.
All right.
That covers it, really. Yeah.
That's actually a pretty low armor value given the series we saw.
15? Yeah, weak. All right, well, let's get serious. Let's actually bring up an actual clip that decides this series. So let's bring that one up.
All right. Pretty similar to the first clip. Again, still 15.
Looks pretty familiar. Yeah. We saw a lot of this, yeah.
Early game armor total.
Yeah. There you go. All right. Well, third time is the charm. So we're going to go to a clip from game number two, which did have a warrior in it, but not in the capacity that we just saw. So let's bring that one up. And Kibler, I'm going to come to you first. This was a really interesting decision here by Matsun. There was a Death Lord on the board. There was multiple ways for him to deal with this. So walk me through some of the possibilities here, Kibler.
Well, there's a couple things when I was looking at this that I was thinking about that I would want to do. One of them is that I feel like both Innervate and Shade are cards that you might want to consider playing this turn, because they're the sort of cards that their value goes down as the game goes on. So we were talking about the possibility of using Keeper to deal damage to the Death Lord, using Wrath, and then innervating out your hero power so you are able to get a minion from the Death Rattle trigger of the Death Lord. The other option is potentially Shade and then using your hero power and just attacking into it. So you're able to still kill the Death Lord the following turn. He chooses to just silence the Death Lord, which was somewhat surprising to me, because that Death Lord is still able to challenge that big game hunter, and now you're no longer able to get the value off of its Death Rattle when it does die.
Yeah, so he doesn't end up, you know, cycling through. He doesn't end up using that Innervate, which, as Kibler said, loses its value as the game goes on. Is it worth it just to push that face damage? What do you think here?
I mean, the big surprise to me is that You know, he has the brawl insurance in the form of the Nerubian Egg that popped out of the piloted Shredder. So you would think that overextending onto the board, that was one of the scenarios where he could get away with it. So I was very surprised to see him leave up what effectively was a 2-8 without taunt, because that could just kill the egg, and then the brawl would be able to potentially get a much more favorable result. So I was definitely thought it was a bit of a curious line, but didn't end up punishing him in the end.
Yeah, the Druid versus Control Warrior matchup just a lot of times is pretty weak. So great series, though. I really enjoyed that one. Lots of control versus control, which leads to some super interesting moments. But we're only halfway through the day after that long series, so we are going to jump into the elimination matches, starting with UCCU versus Staz. But before we do that, let's take a look at some of the highlights from that last match.